The Good Soldier Švejk and His Fortunes in the World War by Jaroslav Hasek, translated by Cecil Parrott, read by David Horovitch for Ukemi Audiobooks. Preface. Great times call for great men. There are unknown heroes who are modest, with none of the historical glamour of a Napoleon. If you analyze their character, you would find that it eclipsed even the glory of Alexander the Great. Today you can meet in the streets of Prague a shabbily dressed man who is not even himself aware of his significance in the history of the great new era. He goes modestly on his way without bothering anyone. Nor is he bothered by journalists asking for an interview. If you asked him his name, he would answer you simply and unassumingly, "I am Švejk." And this quiet, unassuming, shabbily dressed man is indeed that heroic and valiant good old soldier, Švejk. In Austrian times, his name was once on the lips of all the citizens of the Kingdom of Bohemia, and in the Republic, his glory will not fade either. I am very fond of the good soldier Švejk, and in relating his adventures during the World War, I am convinced that this modest, anonymous hero will win the sympathy of all of you. Unlike that stupid fellow Herostratus, he did not set fire to the temple of the goddess in Ephesus just to get himself into the newspapers and schoolbooks. And that is enough. The author. Part 1. Behind the Lines. 1. The good soldier Švejk intervenes in the Great War.
"And so they've killed our Ferdinand," said the charwoman to Mr. Švejk, who had left military service years before, after having been finally certified by an army medical board as an imbecile, and now lived by selling dogs, ugly, mongrel monstrosities whose pedigrees he forged. Apart from this occupation, he suffered from rheumatism, and was at this very moment rubbing his knees with Elliman's embrocation.
"Which Ferdinand, Mrs. Müller?" he asked, going on with the massaging. "I know two Ferdinands. One is a messenger at Prusha's, the chemist's, and once, by mistake, he drank a bottle of hair oil there. And the other is Ferdinand Kokoschka, who collects dog manure. Neither of them is any loss."
"Oh, no, sir, it's His Imperial Highness, the Archduke Ferdinand, from Konopiste, the fat, churchy one."
"Jesus Maria," exclaimed Švejk, "what a grand job. And where did it happen to His Imperial Highness?"
"They bumped him off at Sarajevo, sir, with the revolver, you know. He drove there in a car with his Archduchess."
"Well, there you have it, Mrs. Müller, in a car." "Yes, of course, a gentleman like him can afford it, but he never imagines that a drive like that might finish up badly.
And at Sarajevo into the bargain."
"That's in Bosnia, Mrs. Müller. I expect the Turks did it. You know, we never ought to have taken Bosnia and Herzegovina from them. And so you see, Mrs. Müller, His Imperial Highness now rests with the angels."
"Did he suffer long?"
"His Imperial Highness was done for at once, sir. You know, a revolver isn't just a toy. Not long ago, there was a gentleman in Nusle, where I come from, who fooled about with a revolver too. And what happened? He shot his whole family, and the porter too, who came up to see who was doing the shooting there on the third floor."
"There are some revolvers, Mrs. Müller, that won't go off even if you bust yourself. There are lots of that type. But for His Imperial Highness, I'm sure they must have bought something better.
And I wouldn't mind betting, Mrs. Müller, that the chap who did it put on smart togs for the occasion. Potting at an Imperial Highness is no easy job, you know. It's not like a poacher potting at a gamekeeper. The question is how you get at him. You can't come near a fine gentleman like that if you're dressed in rags. You've got to wear a topper so the cops don't nab you beforehand. They say there are a lot of them, sir."
"Well, of course, Mrs. Müller," said Švejk, finishing massaging his knees. "If you wanted to kill His Imperial Highness, or for that matter, even His Imperial Majesty the Emperor, you'd certainly need advice. Several heads are wiser than one.
One chap advises you this, another that, and then the deed is crowned with success, as our national anthem says. The main thing is to watch out for the moment when a gentleman like that rides past. Just like old Luke Henny, if you remember, who stabbed our late lamented Elizabeth with a file. He just went for a stroll with her. Who's going to trust anybody now? After that, there'll be no more strolls for empresses. And a lot of other persons will have it coming to them too, you know. You mark my words, Mrs. Merler, it'll be the turn of the Tsar and the Tsarina next, and maybe, though God forbid, even of His Imperial Majesty the Emperor, now they've started with his uncle. He's got a lot of enemies, the old gentleman has, even more than Ferdinand. Not long ago, a gentleman was telling us in the pub that a time would come when all these emperors would get done in one after the other, and all the king's horses and all the king's men wouldn't save them. After that, he hadn't any money to pay his bill, and the landlord had to have him arrested. And he hit the landlord across the jaw once, and the policeman twice. So after that, they took him away in a drunk's cart to sober him up again. Well, Mrs. Merler, what a world we live in, to be sure. What a loss for Austria again. When I was in the army, an infantryman once shot a captain. He loaded his rifle and went into his office. They told him he had no business there, but he went on insisting he must speak to the captain. The captain came out and at once gave him confined to barracks. But he took up his rifle and bang it went, plumb through the captain's heart. The bullet flew out of his back and damaged the office into the bargain. It smashed a bottle of ink, which messed up the official documents.
Oh, goodness, and what happened to that soldier?
Asked Mrs. Merler later, while Švejk was dressing.
He hanged himself on his braces, said Švejk, cleaning his bowler. And what's more, they weren't even his. He'd borrowed them from the warder on the excuse that his trousers were falling down. You think he should have waited until they shot him? You know, Mrs. Müller, in a situation like that, anyone would be in a flap. They reduced the warder to the ranks because of it and gave him 6 months. But he didn't sit them out. He ran away to Switzerland, and today he's a preacher of some church or other. Today, there are very few honest people about, Mrs. Müller. I can imagine that His Imperial Highness the Archduke Ferdinand made a mistake in Sarajevo about that chap who shot him. He saw a gentleman and thought, he must be a decent fellow who's giving me a cheer. And instead of that, he gave him bang bang.
Did he give him one bang or several, Mrs. Müller? The newspaper says, sir, that His Imperial Highness was riddled like a sieve. He emptied all his cartridges into him.
Well, it goes jolly quickly, Mrs. Müller, terribly quickly. I'd buy a Browning for a job like that. It looks like a toy, but in a couple of minutes you can shoot 20 archdukes with it, never mind whether they're thin or fat. Although, between you and me, Mrs. Müller, a fat archduke's a better mark than a thin one. You may remember the time they shot that king of theirs in Portugal. He was a fat chap, too. After all, you wouldn't expect a king to be thin, would you? Well, now I'm going to the pub, the Chalice, and if anyone comes here for that miniature pincher, which I took an advance on, tell them I've got him in my kennels in the country, that I've only just cropped his ears, and he mustn't be moved until they heal up, otherwise they'll catch cold. Would you please give the key to the house porter?
There was only one guest sitting at the Chalice. It was the plainclothes police officer, Brett Schneider, who worked for the state security. The landlord, Palivetch, was washing up the glasses, and Brett Schneider was vainly endeavouring to engage him in serious conversation. Palivetch was notorious for his foul mouth. Every second word of his was arse or shit. But at the same time, he was well-read and told everyone to read what Victor Hugo wrote on this subject when he described the last answer Napoleon's old guard gave to the British at the Battle of Waterloo.
"Well, it's a glorious summer," said Brett Schneider, embarking on his serious conversation.
"Shit on everything," answered Palivetch, putting the glasses away into a cupboard.
"It's a fine thing they've done to us at Sarajevo," said Bretschneider, with a faint hope.
"Which Sarajevo?" asked Palevich. "Do you mean the wine cellar at Nussel? They're always fighting there, you know. Of course it's Nussel."
"No, it's Sarajevo in Bosnia, Mr. Palevich. They've just shot His Imperial Highness, the Archduke Ferdinand, there. What do you say to that?"
"I don't poke my nose into things like that. They can kiss my arse if I do,"
Palevich replied politely, lighting his pipe.
"Nowadays, if anyone got mixed up in a business like that, he'd risk breaking his neck. I'm a tradesman. And when anyone comes in here and orders a beer, I fill up his glass. But Sarajevo, politics, or the late lamented Archduke are nothing for people like us. They lead straight to Pankrach."
Bretschneider lapsed into silence and looked disappointedly around the empty pub.
"Hello, there used to be a picture of His Imperial Majesty hanging here once," he started up again after a while. "Just where the mirror hangs now."
"Yes, you're right,"
Palevich replied.
"It did hang there, but the flies used to shit on it, so I put it away in the attic. You know, somebody might be so free as to pass a remark about it, and then there could be unpleasantness. I don't want that, do I?"
"In Sarajevo, it must have been a pretty ugly business, Mr. Palevich."
This crafty, direct question evoked an extremely cautious answer from Palevich.
"At this time of the year, it's scorching hot in Bosnia and Herzegovina. When I served there, they had to put ice on our lieutenant's head."
Which regiment did you serve in, Mr. Palevich?"
"I can't possibly remember anything so unimportant. Bloody nonsense of that sort never interested me, and I've never bothered my head about it,"
answered Palevich.
"Curiosity killed a cat."
Bretschneider finally relapsed into silence. His gloomy face only lit up on the arrival of Švejk, who came into the pub, ordered a dark black beer, and remarked, "Today there'll be mourning in Vienna, too." Bretschneider's eyes gleamed with hope, and he said laconically,
"On Konopiste there are 10 black flags."
"There should be 12, said Švejk, after he had taken a swig.
"And what makes you think 12?
Asked Bretschneider. "To make it a round number. A dozen adds up better, and dozens always come cheaper," answered Švejk. There was a silence, which Švejk himself broke with a sigh. "And so he's already lying with God and the angels. Glory be, he didn't even live to be emperor. When I was serving in the army, a general once fell off his horse and killed himself without any fuss. They wanted to help him back onto his horse to lift him up, but to their surprise, he was completely dead, and he was going to be promoted field marshal. It happened at a review." "These reviews never come to any good." "In Sarajevo, there was a review, too. I remember once at a parade like that, I had 20 buttons missing from my uniform, and they sent me into solitary confinement for a fortnight, where I lay for 2 days, trussed up like Lazarus. But in the army, you must have discipline, otherwise, why would anyone bother at all? Our Lieutenant Makovich always used to say, 'There's got to be discipline, you bloody fools, otherwise you'd be climbing about on the trees like monkeys. But the army's going to make human beings of you, you godforsaken idiots.' And isn't that true? Just imagine a park, let's say at Charles Square, and on every tree an undisciplined soldier. It's enough to give you a nightmare."
"At Sarajevo," Bretschneider resumed, "it was the Serbs who did it."
You're wrong there," replied Švejk. "It was the Turks because of Bosnia and Herzegovina." And Švejk expounded his views on Austrian foreign policy in the Balkans. In 1912, the Turks lost the war with Serbia, Bulgaria, and Greece. They had wanted Austria to help them, and when this didn't happen, they shot Ferdinand. "Do you like the Turks?" said Švejk, turning to Palevich. "Do you like those heathen dogs? You don't, do you?"
"One customer is as good as another," said Palevich. "Never mind a Turk. For tradesmen like us, politics doesn't enter into it. Pay for your beer, sit down in my pub and jabber what you like. That's my principle. It's all the same to me whether our Ferdinand was done in by a Serb or Turk, Catholic or Muslim, anarchist or young Czech.
All right now, Mr. Palevich, resumed Bretschneider, who was again beginning to despair of catching either of them out. But all the same, you'll admit that it's a great loss for Austria. Schweig replied for the landlord.
Yes, it's a loss indeed. There's no denying it. A shocking loss. You can't replace Ferdinand by any tuppenny-halfpenny idiot. Only he ought to have been still fatter.
What do you mean? Bretschneider livened up.
What do I mean?
Schweig answered happily.
Just this. If he'd been fatter, then of course he'd certainly have had a stroke long ago when he was chasing those old women at Konopiste when they were collecting firewood and picking mushrooms on his estate, and he wouldn't have had to die such a shameful death. Just imagine, an uncle of His Imperial Majesty and shot. Why, it's a scandal. The newspapers are full of it.
Years ago, in our Budyovice, a cattle dealer called Bretislav Ludwig was stabbed in the marketplace in a petty squabble. He had a son called Bohuslav, and wherever that lad came to sell his pigs, no one wanted to buy anything from him, and everyone said, "That's the son of that chap who was stabbed. He's probably a first-class bastard, too." There was nothing for him to do but to jump into the Vlatovar from that bridge at Kromlov. And they had to drag him out, resurrect him, pump water out of him. And of course, he had to die in the arms of the doctor just when he was giving him an injection.
You do make strange comparisons, I must say, said Bretschneider significantly. First you talk about Ferdinand, and then about a cattle dealer.
Oh, no, I don't, Schweig defended himself. God forbid my wanting to compare anyone to anybody else. Mr. Palevich knows me very well. I've never compared anyone to anybody else, have I? But I wouldn't for the life of me want to be in the skin of that Archduke's widow. What's she going to do now? The children are orphans, and the family estate at Konopiste has no master. Marry a new Archduke? What would she get out of that? She'd only go with him to Sarajevo again and be widowed a second time.
You know, years ago, there was a gamekeeper in Svliv, near Chluboka. He had a very ugly name, Pindua. Some poachers shot him, and he left a widow and two little babes. Within a year, she married another gamekeeper, Pepik Sharvel from Midlovery, and they shot him too. And then she married a third time, again, a gamekeeper, and said, "Third time lucky. If it doesn't succeed this time, then I don't know what I shall do." Well, of course, they shot him too. And with all these gamekeepers, she had six children altogether. She even went to the office of His Highness the Prince at Kluboka and complained that she'd had trouble with those gamekeepers. And so they recommended her a fellow called Yaresh, who was a water bailiff in the watchtower at Razice. And can you imagine it? He was drowned when they were fishing the lake out, and she had two children by him. And then she took a pig gelder from Vodnani, and one night he hit her over the head with his axe and went and gave himself up voluntarily. And when they hanged him afterwards at the district court at Pisek, he bit the priest's nose and said he didn't regret anything. And he also said something extremely nasty about His Imperial Majesty.
And you don't happen to know what he said? Bretschneider asked, hopefully.
I can't tell you because no one dared repeat it. But I'm told that it was something so dreadful and horrible that one of the magistrates went mad, and they keep him to this very day in solitary confinement so that it shan't get out. It wasn't the usual sort of insulting remark which people make about His Imperial Majesty when they're tight.
And what sort of insulting remark do people make about His Imperial Majesty when they're tight? Asked Bretschneider.
Now come, gentlemen, please change the subject, said Palevich. You know I don't like it. Somebody might talk out of turn and we'd be sorry for it.
What sort of insulting remarks do people make about His Imperial Majesty when they're tight? Schweig repeated. All kinds. Get drunk, have the Austrian national anthem played, and you'll see what you start saying. You'll think up such a lot about His Imperial Majesty that if only half of it were true, it would be enough to disgrace him all his life. but the old gentleman really doesn't deserve it. Just think, his son, Rudolph, lost in tender years in full flower of his manhood, his wife, Elizabeth, stabbed with a file, and then Janosch, also lost. His brother, the Emperor of Mexico, put up against a wall and shot in a fortress somewhere. And now again, in his old age, they've shot his uncle. A chap needs iron nerves for that. And then some drunken bastard starts to swear at him. If the balloon went up today, I'd go as a volunteer and serve His Imperial Majesty to my last drop of blood.
Švejk took a deep draught of beer and continued,
Do you really think His Imperial Majesty is going to put up with this sort of thing? If so, you don't know him at all. There'll have to be a war with the Turks. You killed my uncle, and so I'll bash your jaw. War is certain. Serbia and Russia will help us in it. There won't half be a bloodbath.
Švejk looked beautiful in this prophetic moment. His simple face, smiling like a full moon, beamed with enthusiasm. Everything was so clear to him.
It may be, he said, continuing his account of Austria's future, that if we have war with the Turks, the Germans will attack us because the Germans and the Turks stick together. You can't find bigger bastards anywhere. But we can ally ourselves with France, which has had a down on Germany ever since 1871. And then the balloon will go up. There'll be war. I won't say any more.
Retschneider stood up and said solemnly, You don't need to. Just come along with me into the passage. I've got something to say to you there. Švejk followed the plainclothes police officer into the passage, where a little surprise awaited him. His drinking companion showed him his eaglet and announced that he was arresting him and would take him at once to police headquarters. Švejk tried to explain that the gentleman must be mistaken, that he was completely innocent, and that he had not uttered a single word capable of offending anyone. However, Retschneider told him that he had in fact committed several criminal offences, including the crime of high treason. Then they returned to the pub, and Švejk said to Palivec, I've had 5 beers, a couple of frankfurters, and a roll. Now give me one more slivovitz and I must go, because I'm under arrest. Retschneider showed Palivec his eaglet, stared at him for a moment, and then asked, Are you married?
I am.
And can Madame carry on the business for you during your absence?
She can.
Then it's all right, Mr. Palivec, said Retschneider gaily. Call your wife here, give the business over to her, and in the evening we'll come for you.
Take it easy, Švejk consoled him. I'm only going there for high treason.
But what am I going for? Moaned Palivec. After all, I've been so careful.
Retschneider smiled and said triumphantly, Because you said the flies shitted on His Imperial Majesty. They'll certainly knock His Imperial Majesty out of your head there. And so Švejk left the chalice under the escort of the plainclothes police officer. When they went out into the street, his face lit up with its good-natured smile, and he asked, Should I step down from the pavement?
What do you mean?
I thought, as I'm under arrest, I've no right to walk on the pavement.
When they passed through the door of police headquarters, Švejk said,
Well, the time passed very pleasantly for us there. Do you often go to the chalice?
And while they were escorting Švejk to the reception office, Palivec at the chalice handed over the running of the pub to his weeping wife, consoling her in his own inimitable way.
Don't cry! Don't howl! What can they do to me because of some shit on a picture of His Imperial Majesty?
And thus it was that the good soldier Švejk intervened in the Great War in his own sweet, charming way. It will interest historians that he saw far into the future. If the situation subsequently developed otherwise than he had expounded it at the chalice, we must bear in mind that he had never had any preparatory training in diplomacy.
2. The Good Soldier Švejk at Police Headquarters. The Sarajevo assassination had filled police headquarters with numerous victims. They were brought in one after another, and the old inspector at the reception office said in his kindly tone, "That Ferdinand is going to cost you dear." When they had locked Švejk up in one of the numerous cells on the first floor, he found 6 persons already assembled there. 5 of them were sitting round the table, and in a corner, a middle-aged man was sitting on a bunk as though trying to avoid the company of the others. Švejk started asking them in turn why they had been arrested. From the 5 sitting at the table, he received almost exactly the same answer. Because of Sarajevo, because of Ferdinand, because of the murder of His Imperial Highness, for Ferdinand, because they did away with His Imperial Highness at Sarajevo. The 6th, who was avoiding the company of the other 5, said he did not want to have anything to do with them in case any suspicion should fall on him. He was only detained here for attempted robbery with murder on a farmer Giles from Holice. Švejk sat down at the table with the conspirators, who were recounting for at least the 10th time how they had got there. All except one had been taken in a pub, a wine cellar, or a cafe. The exception was an unusually fat gentleman with glasses and tear-stained eyes who had been arrested in his apartment because 2 days before the murder at Sarajevo, he had stood drinks to 2 Serbian students of engineering at the pub Ubreški and had been seen by Detective Brixi drunk in their company in Montmartre in Retežova Street, where, as he had already confirmed by his signature on the police report, he had stood them drinks too. In reply to all questions during the preliminary investigation at police headquarters, he repeated the stereotyped moan, "I keep a stationer's shop," whereupon he received the equally stereotyped reply, "That's no excuse." The short gentleman who had been taken in the wine cellar was a professor of history and was expounding to the landlord the history of various assassinations. He was arrested at the very moment when he had completed a psychological analysis of every assassination and was saying, "The idea of an assassination is as simple as Columbus's egg." "Yes, just as simple as your for Pankratz," said the police inspector during the interrogation, capping his remark. The 3rd conspirator was the president of the charity organization Dobromil at Hodakovichki. On the day the assassination took place, Dobromil had organized a garden party with a concert. The sergeant of the gendarmerie came to ask the public to go home, as Austria was in mourning, whereupon the president of Dobromil said good-naturedly, "Just wait a moment until we have finished playing Hedge Slovane." Now he was sitting there with bowed head and lamenting, "In August we have new elections for the presidency. If I'm not home by then, I may not be elected. It's the 10th time I'm president. I'll never survive the shame." The late lamented Ferdinand played an odd trick on the 4th detainee, a man of sterling character and blameless reputation. For 2 whole days he had avoided any talk about Ferdinand until, in the evening in the café, while playing Marias and trumping the King of Spades with the 7 of clubs, he said, "7 pips, like at Sarajevo." The 5th man, who, as he said himself, was detained there because of that murder of His Imperial Highness at Sarajevo, was so scared that his hair and beard was still standing on end, and his head reminded one of a stable pincher. This man had not uttered a single word in the restaurant where he'd been arrested. He'd not even read the newspapers about the murder of Ferdinand, and was sitting alone at the table when a gentleman came up to him, sat down opposite him, and said to him quickly, "Have you read it?" "No." "Do you know about it?" "No." "And do you know what it's about?" "No, I'm not interested." "But you ought to be interested." "I don't know what I ought to be interested in. I just smoke my cigar, drink my few glasses, have my supper, and don't read the newspapers. The newspapers tell lies. Why should I get excited?"
"And so you're not even interested in the murder at Sarajevo, then?"
"I'm not interested in any murder at all, whether it's at Prague, Vienna, Sarajevo, or London.
For that there are authorities, courts and police. If at any time anywhere they kill anybody, it only serves him right. Why is he such a bloody careless fool to let himself get killed?
Those were his last words in this conversation. From that moment he went on repeating aloud at intervals of 5 minutes,
"I'm innocent! I'm innocent!"
He screamed out these words at the gate of police headquarters. He is going to repeat them when he's transferred to the criminal court in Prague, and with these words he will enter his prison cell. When Švejk had heard all these dreadful conspiratorial tales, he thought it right to explain to the others the utter hopelessness of their position.
"We're all of us in a nasty jam," he began his words of comfort. "You're not right when you say that nothing can happen to you or any of us. What have we got the police for except to punish us for talking out a turn? If the times are so dangerous that archdukes get shot, no one should be surprised if he's carried off to police headquarters. They're doing all this to make a splash, so that Ferdinand can have some publicity before his funeral. The more of us there are here, the better it'll be for us, because it'll be all the jollier. When I was in the army, half a company of us were sometimes locked up together. And how many innocent people used to be condemned? And not only in the army, but in the civil courts too. I remember once a woman was sentenced for strangling her newly born twins, although she swore on oath that she couldn't have strangled twins when she'd given birth to only one little girl, which she had succeeded in strangling quite painlessly. She was sentenced for double murder all the same. Or that innocent gypsy in Zabelice who broke into a greengrocer's shop on Christmas Day in the night. He swore that he'd gone there to get warm, but it didn't help. Once it gets into the hands of the courts, it's bad. But that bad has to be. Perhaps all people aren't such scoundrels as you'd think them to be. But how can you tell the good chap from the rotter, especially nowadays at such a serious time as this when they bumped off Ferdinand? When I served in the army in Budyovice, the captain's dog got shot in a forest behind the parade ground. When he learnt about it, he summoned us all, made us fall in, and ordered every tenth man to step forward. Of course, it goes without saying that I was one of the tenth men. And so we stood at attention without batting an eyelid. The captain went along our ranks and said, "You bastards, you swine, you brutes, you spotted hyenas, you, because of that dog, I'd like to send every bloody one of you into solitary confinement. Make macaroni out of you, shoot you up and make kedgeree out of you. And to show you I'm not going to be soft with you, I'm giving all of you 14 days CB. And so there you see. Then it was all because of a mangy cur. Now it's all because of no less a person than His Imperial Highness. You have to have some horror to make the mourning worthwhile."
"I'm innocent, I'm innocent,"
repeated the man with his hair on end.
"Jesus Christ was innocent too," said Švejk, "and all the same they crucified him. No one anywhere has ever worried about a man being innocent. Maul halten und weiter dienen, as they used to tell us in the army. That's the best and finest thing of all."
Švejk lay down on the bunk and fell asleep contentedly. Meanwhile, they brought in two new detainees. One of them was a Bosnian. He walked up and down the cell, grinding his teeth, and every time he opened his mouth said, "Jeben ti dusu." He was tortured by the thought that his peddler's basket would get lost at police headquarters. The other new guest was the landlord, Palivec. When he saw his friend, Švejk, he woke him up and called out in the most tragic tones,
"Now I'm here too!"
Švejk shook his hand cordially and said,
"I'm glad about that, really I am. I knew that gentleman would keep his word when he said that they'd come for you. Punctiliousness like that is a good thing."
But Palivec remarked that punctiliousness of that sort was not worth a shit, and lowering his voice, asked Švejk whether the other gentlemen under arrest were thieves, because it might harm his business. Švejk explained to him that all of them belonged to the same party arrested because of the Archduke, except the man who'd been arrested for attempted robbery with murder on a farmer Giles from Holice. Palevich took umbrage at this and said that he was not here for any pipsqueak of an Archduke, but because of his Imperial Majesty. And because the others began to show interest, he told him how his flies had defiled his Imperial Majesty.
"They fouled him up for me, the vermin," he said,
ending the description of his adventure,
"and finally they got me locked up. I'll never forgive those flies for that," he added menacingly.
Švejk went back to bed, but he did not sleep long because they came to take him away for questioning. And so, mounting the staircase to the third department for questioning, Švejk carried his cross up onto the hill of Golgotha, sublimely unconscious of his martyrdom. Observing the notice that spitting in the corridors was prohibited, he asked the policeman to allow him to spit in the spittoon, and beaming with his natural simplicity, said as he came into the office, "A very good evening to you all, gentlemen." Instead of a reply, someone pummeled him under the ribs and stood him in front of a table, behind which there sat a gentleman with a cold, official face, and features of such bestial cruelty that he might have just fallen out of Lombroso's book, Criminal Types. He gave Švejk a bloodthirsty look and said,
"Take that idiotic expression off your face."
"I can't help it," replied Švejk solemnly. "I was discharged from the army for idiocy and officially certified by a special commission as an idiot. I'm an official idiot."
The gentleman of the criminal type ground his teeth. "What you're accused of and you've committed proves you've got all your wits about you." And now he proceeded to enumerate to Švejk a whole series of different crimes, beginning with high treason and ending with abuse of His Majesty and members of the Imperial family. The central gem of this collection was Švejk's approval of the murder of the Archduke Ferdinand, from which there branched out a string of fresh crimes, among which the shining light was the crime of incitement, as it had all happened in a public place.
"What do you say to that?"
the gentleman with features of bestial cruelty asked triumphantly.
"There's a lot of it," Švejk replied innocently. "You can have too much of a good thing."
"So, there you are then. You admit it's true?"
"I admit everything. You've got to be strict. Without strictness, no one would ever get anywhere. When I was in the army..."
"Shut your mug!" shouted the police commissioner. "And speak only when you're questioned. Do you understand?"
"Of course I understand," said Švejk. "Humbly report, I understand and am able to orientate myself in everything you're pleased to say, sir."
"Whom are you in contact with?"
"My charwoman, Your Honour."
"And you don't have any friends in political circles here?"
Yes, I do, Your Honour. I subscribe to the afternoon edition of Narodny Politika, The Bitch."
"Get out!"
the gentleman with the bestial appearance roared at Švejk. As they were leading him out of the office, Švejk said,
"Good night, Your Honour."
Back in his cell, Švejk told all the detainees that this kind of interrogation was fun.
They shout at you a bit and finally they kick you out. "In the old days," continued Švejk, "it used to be worse. I once read in a book how the accused had to walk on red-hot iron and drink molten lead to prove whether they were innocent or not. Or else they put their legs into Spanish boots or strung them up on the ladder if they wouldn't confess. Or they burnt their hips with a fireman's torch like they did to St. John of Nepomuk. They say that when they did it to him, he screamed like blue murder and didn't stop until they'd thrown him from Ilishka's bridge in a watertight sack. There were many cases like that. And even after that, they went and quartered the chap or stuck him on a stake somewhere near the museum. And if a chap like that was only thrown into a dungeon, he felt as if he were reborn. Nowadays it's fun being locked up," Švejk continued with relish. "There's no quartering, no Spanish boots. We've got bunks, a table, a bench. We're not all squashed together like sardines. We get soup, they give us bread and bring us a jug of water. We've got our latrines right under our snouts. You can see progress in everything. It's true that it's a bit far to the interrogation room. You've got to go along more than three corridors and up one staircase, but on the other hand, it's clean and lively in the corridors. They bring one person here, another there, young, old, male and female. You can be glad that at least you're not alone here. Everyone goes his own sweet way, and no one need be afraid that in the office they'll tell him, "Well, we've considered your case, and tomorrow you'll be quartered or burnt. The choice is up to you." That certainly wasn't an easy choice to make, and I think, gentlemen, that many of us at a time like that would be completely flummoxed by it. Yes, nowadays things have improved for our good. He had just finished his defence of the modern way of imprisoning citizens when a warder opened the door and shouted, "Švejk, get dressed and come for interrogation."
"I shall indeed," answered Švejk. "I've got no objection, but I'm afraid that there may be some mistake here. I've already been thrown out from interrogation once, and I'm afraid that these other gentlemen who are here with me will be cross with me if I go twice for interrogation when they haven't been there even once the whole evening. They might be jealous of me."
"Get out and stop talking drivel," was the reply to Švejk's
gentlemanly utterance. Švejk again found himself face to face with the gentleman of criminal type, who, without beating about the bush, asked him harshly and irrevocably,
"Do you confess to everything?"
Švejk fixed his good blue eyes on the ruthless man and said softly,
"If you want me to confess, your worship, I shall. It can't do me any harm. But if you say, 'Švejk, don't confess to anything,' I'll wriggle and wriggle out of it until there isn't a breath left in my body."
The severe gentleman wrote something on the documents, and handing Švejk a pen, invited him to sign it. And Švejk signed Brettschneider's deposition with the following addition: "All the above accusations against me are founded on fact. Josef Švejk." When he had signed, he turned to the severe gentleman.
"Have I got to sign anything else? Or am I to come back in the morning?"
"In the morning you'll be taken off to the criminal court," was the answer.
"At what time, your worship, so that I don't oversleep, for Christ's sake?"
"Get out!"
For the second time that day there was a roar from the other side of the table in front of which Švejk was standing. Returning to his new home behind bars, Švejk told the policeman who was escorting him,
"Everything here goes like a house on fire."
As soon as the door closed behind him, his fellow prisoners deluged him with questions of all kinds, to which he replied clearly,
"I've just admitted that I might have murdered the Archduke Ferdinand."
Six men crouched in horror under the lice-ridden blankets. Only the Bosnian said,
"Dobro došli, welcome."
As he lay down on the bunk, Švejk said,
"It's stupid that we haven't got an alarm clock here."
But in the morning he was woken up without an alarm clock, and at 6 o'clock sharp he was carried away to the criminal court in the Green Antony.
"The early bird catches the worm," said Švejk
to his fellow travellers, when the Green Antony drove out of the gates of police headquarters. 3. Švejk before the medical experts. The clean, cosy cubicles of the regional criminal court made the most favourable impression on Švejk. The whitewashed walls, the black-painted bars, and the fat Mr. Demartini, the chief warder for the prisoners on remand, with his purple facings and purple braid on his government-supplied cap. Purple is the colour prescribed not only here, but also at religious services on Ash Wednesday and Good Friday. The glorious times of Roman rule over Jerusalem were coming back. The prisoners were led out and brought before the Pontius Pilates of 1914 down on the ground floor. And the examining magistrates, the Pilates of modern times, instead of honourably washing their hands, sent to Tysig's for goulash and Pilsen beer and passed more and more indictments to the Director of Prosecutions. Here all logic mostly disappeared, and the section triumphed. The section strangled, went mad, fumed, laughed, threatened, murdered, and gave no quarter. The magistrates were jugglers with the law, high priests of its letter, devourers of the accused, tigers of the Austrian jungle, who measured their spring on the accused by the number of clauses. The exception were a few gentlemen, as at police headquarters, who did not take the law quite so seriously, for everywhere wheat can be found among the tares. It was to one of these gentlemen that they conducted Švejk for questioning. He was an elderly gentleman of affable appearance, who, when he was once interrogating the notorious murderer, Valish, never failed to tell him, "Be so good as to sit down, Mr. Valish. There is an empty chair just here." When they led Švejk before him, with his natural amiability, he asked him to sit down and said, "So, you are this Mr. Švejk, then?"
"I think I must be," answered Švejk, "because my papa was Mr. Švejk and my mamma was Mrs. Švejk. I can't disgrace them by denying my own name."
A kindly smile flitted across the face of the examining magistrate.
"Well, you've been up to a fine lot of things. You've certainly got a great deal on your conscience."
"I've always got a great deal on my conscience," said Švejk, smiling even more affably than the magistrate. "I've probably got more on my conscience than your worship is pleased to have."
"Well, that's clear from the statement you've signed," said the magistrate, in a no less affable tone. "They didn't bring any pressure on you at the police station, did they?"
"Why, of course not, your worship. I asked them myself if I had to sign it, and when they told me to do so, I obeyed. After all, I wouldn't want to quarrel with them just because of my signature, would I? It certainly wouldn't be in my interest to do that. There must be law and order."
"Do you feel completely well, Mr. Švejk?"
"Not completely well, no, I wouldn't say that, your worship. I've got rheumatism, and I rub myself with Elliman's embrocation."
The old gentleman again gave a kindly smile.
"What would you say if we were to have you examined by our medical experts?"
"I don't think that I can be so bad that these gentlemen need unnecessarily waste their time on me. I was examined by one doctor already at police headquarters to see if I got VD.
"You know, all the same, Mr. Švejk, we'll try with these medical experts. We'll set up a nice commission and keep you in remand under investigation. In the meantime, you'll have a nice rest. Now, just one more question. Is it true, as it is stated in the report, that you declared and widely disseminated the view that war would soon break out?"
"Oh, yes, your worship, and it will break out very soon indeed."
"And you don't occasionally feel run down, by any chance?"
"Oh, no, sir. I was only once nearly run down by a car on Charles Square, but that was many years ago."
That concluded the interrogation. Švejk shook hands with the magistrate, and after having returned to his cell, said to his neighbours,
"Now, all because of that murder of His Imperial Highness the Archduke Ferdinand, they're going to have me examined by the medical experts."
"I've been examined by those medical experts too," said a young man. "That was when I had to come before a jury about some carpets. They certified me as feeble-minded. Now I've embezzled a steam threshing machine and they can't do anything to me. My lawyer told me yesterday that once I've been certified feeble-minded, I'll have the benefit of it for the rest of my life."
"I don't trust those medical experts at all," observed the man with the intelligent appearance. "Once, when I forged some bills of exchange, I prepared myself for all eventualities and went to lectures by the psychiatrist, Dr. Heveroch, and when they caught me, I pretended to be a paralytic, exactly as Dr. Heveroch had described one. I bit one of the medical experts on the commission in the leg, drank ink out of the inkpot, and relieved myself, if you'll pardon the expression, gentlemen, in the corner, in the view of the whole commission. But because I bit one of them through the calf, they certified me as completely fit, and so I was done for."
"I'm not a bit afraid of these gentlemen's examinations," said Švejk. "When I was in the army, a vet examined me, and it didn't turn out at all badly."
"Medical experts are swine,"
the short man with a stoop broke in.
Not long ago, quite by chance, they dug up a skeleton in my meadow, and the medical expert said that it was murdered 40 years ago by some blunt object on the head. I'm 38, and I've been jailed, although I have my birth certificate, an extract from the parish register, and my identity card.
I think that we should be fair about everything, said Švejk. After all, anybody can and must make a mistake the more he thinks about a thing. Medical experts are human beings, and human beings have their faults. Once, in Nussel, just by the bridge across the Butich, a gentleman came up to me in the night when I was coming back from Ubanzetu and hit me over the head with a knout. And when I was lying on the ground, he flashed his torch on me and said, "It's a mistake. It's not him." And he got so angry because he'd made a mistake that he hit me on the back again. It's only human nature that a chap should go on making mistakes until he dies. It's just like that gentleman who one night found a mad, half-frozen dog, took it home with him and put it in his wife's bed. As soon as it had got warmed up, it bit the whole family and tore to pieces and devoured the baby in the cradle. Or I can give you an example of a mistake a turner who lives in our house once made. He opened the chapel at Podoli with his key because he thought it was his kitchen, and lay down on the altar because he thought that he was home in bed. And then he pulled over himself some cloths with holy inscriptions and put the New Testament and other sacred books under his head to make it higher. In the morning he was found by the sexton, and when he came to himself he told him quite good-humouredly that it was only a little mistake.
"A nice little mistake," said the sexton, "when all because of it we shall have to have the church reconsecrated."
After that, the turner came before the medical experts, and they proved to him that he had been completely sensible and sober, because if he had been tight, they said, he wouldn't have been able to fit the key into the lock of the chapel door. Afterwards, that turner died in Pankrac. I can also give you another example of how a police dog at Kladno made a mistake. It was an Alsatian which belonged to the famous cavalry captain Rotter. Captain Rotter bred these dogs and experimented with them on tramps until all the tramps began to avoid the district of Kladno. And so he gave orders that the gendarmes must bring in some suspicious individual without fail. Well, once they brought him a quite respectably dressed man whom they'd found in the forest of Lani sitting on a tree stump. The captain at once had a piece of his coat tails cut off and given to his police dogs to sniff. And then they took the man away to a brickworks behind the town and set their trained dogs onto his tracks. The dogs found him and brought him back again. Then the man had to climb up a ladder to a loft, leap over a wall, and jump into a lake with the dogs after him. In the end, it turned out that he was a deputy of the Czech Radical Party who'd gone for an outing in the woods of Lani after having got bored with Parliament. And that's why I say that people are erring creatures by nature. They make errors, never mind whether they're learned people or stupid, uneducated idiots. Even ministers make mistakes.
The commission of medical experts, which had to decide whether Švejk's mental horizon did or did not correspond to all the crimes with which he was charged, consisted of three unusually solemn gentlemen, whose views were such that the view of each differed gloriously from any of the views of the other two. Three different scientific schools and psychiatric views were represented there. If, in the case of Švejk, complete agreement had been reached between these opposing scientific camps, it can be explained purely and simply by the stunning impression he produced upon them when he entered the room where his mental state was to be examined, and, observing a picture of the Austrian monarch hanging on the wall, cried out, "Long live our Emperor Franz Josef I, gentlemen!" The case was clear as daylight. Švejk's spontaneous declaration disposed of a whole range of questions, and there only remained a few very important questions which were needed, so that from Švejk's answers, the initial opinion of him could be confirmed according to the system of the psychiatrist Dr. Callison, Dr. Heverock, and the Englishman, Viking.
"Is radium heavier than lead?"
"Please, sir, I haven't weighed it."
answered Švejk with his sweet smile.
Do you believe in the end of the world?
I'd have to see that end first, Švejk answered nonchalantly, but certainly I shan't see it tomorrow.
Would you know how to calculate the diameter of the globe?
No, I'm afraid I wouldn't, answered Švejk, but I'd like to ask you a riddle myself, gentlemen. Take a three-storied house with 8 windows on each floor. On the roof, there are 2 dormer windows and 2 chimneys. On every floor, there are 2 tenants. And now tell me, gentlemen, in which year the house porter's grandmother died.
The medical experts exchanged knowing looks, but nevertheless one of them asked this further question.
You don't know the maximum depth of the Pacific Ocean?
No, please, sir, I don't, was the answer. But I think that it must be definitely deeper than the Vultifer below the rock of Visharad.
The chairman of the commission asked briefly, Is that enough? But nonetheless, another member requested the following question. How much is 12,897 times 13,863?
729, answered Švejk, without batting an eyelid.
I think that will do, said the chairman of the commission. You can take the accused back where he came from.
Thank you, gentlemen, replied Švejk, deferentially. For me it will do, too.
After his departure, the three agreed that Švejk was a patent imbecile and idiot, according to all the natural laws invented by the luminaries of psychiatry. The report, which was passed to the examining magistrate, contained inter alia the following. The undersigned medical experts certify the complete mental feebleness and congenital idiocy of Josef Švejk, who appeared before the aforesaid commission and expressed himself in terms such as Long live our Emperor Franz Josef I, which utterance is sufficient to illuminate the state of mind of Josef Švejk as that of a patent imbecile. The undersigned commission accordingly recommends 1. That the investigation of Josef Švejk be quashed, 2. That Josef Švejk be sent to a psychiatrical clinic for observation to establish how far his mental state is a danger to his surroundings. While this report was being compiled, Švejk was telling his fellow prisoners, They didn't care a hoot about Ferdinand, but talked to me about even stupider nonsense. Finally, we agreed that what we talked about was quite enough for us, and we parted.
I don't believe anyone, observed the short man with a stoop on whose meadow a skeleton happened to have been dug up. They're all of them a gang of crooks.
There have to be crooks in this world, too, said Švejk, lying down on his straw mattress. If everyone were honest with each other, they'd soon start punching each other's noses.
4. Švejk thrown out of the lunatic asylum. When Švejk subsequently described life in the lunatic asylum, he did so in exceptionally eulogistic terms.
I really don't know why those loonies get so angry when they're kept there. You can crawl naked on the floor, howl like a jackal, rage and bite. If anyone did this anywhere on the promenade, people would be astonished. But there, it's the most common or garden thing to do. There's a freedom there which not even socialists have ever dreamt of. A chap can pass himself off as God Almighty, the Virgin Mary, the Pope, the King of England, His Imperial Majesty, or Saint Wenceslas. Although the chap who said he was St. Wenceslas was tied up naked all day long and lay in solitary confinement. There was also a chap who shouted out that he was the Archbishop, but all he did was to eat, and, if you'll pardon the expression, do something else which rhymes with it, excrete. But no one's ashamed of doing that there. One chap even pretended to be St. Cyril and St. Methodius just to get a double portion. And there was one gentleman there who was pregnant and invited everyone to the christening. There were many people shut up there who were chess players, politicians, fishermen and scouts, stamp collectors and amateur photographers. One person was there because of some old pots which he called funerary urns. One was in a straitjacket all the time so that he shouldn't be able to calculate when the world would come to an end. And I also met a certain number of professors there.
One of them used to follow me about all the time and expatiate on how the cradle of the gypsy race was in the Krokonoshe, and the other explained to me that inside the globe there was another globe much bigger than the outer one. Everyone there could say exactly what he pleased and what was on the tip of his tongue, just as if he was in Parliament. Sometimes they used to tell each other fairy stories and started fighting when something very bad happened to a princess. The wildest of them all was a gentleman who pretended to be the 16th volume of Otto's encyclopedia and asked everybody to open him and to find the entry cardboard box stapling machine, otherwise he would be done for. He only quietened down when they put him in a straitjacket. Then he was happy, because he thought he'd got into a bookbinder's press and begged to be given a modern trim. It was really like living in paradise there. You could kick up a row, fight, sing, cry, bleat, yell, jump, say your prayers, turn somersaults, crawl on all fours, hop, run about, dance, skip, squat all day on your haunches and climb up the walls. No one would come to you and tell you, "You mustn't do that, sir, it's not decent. You should be ashamed of yourself. Aren't you properly brought up?" It's true, however, that there are loonies there who are quite quiet. There was one well-brought-up inventor, for instance, who continually picked his nose and said only once a day, "I've just discovered electricity." As I say, it was very pleasant there, and those few days which I spent in the lunatic asylum are among the loveliest hours of my life. And indeed, the very welcome which awaited Švejk in the asylum when they had taken him away from the criminal court and brought him there for observation surpassed his expectations. First they stripped him naked, then they gave him a hospital gown and led him off to have a bath, holding him familiarly under his arms while one of the male nurses entertained him by telling him some jokes about Jews. In the bathroom they immersed him in a tub of warm water and then pulled him out and put him under a cold douche. They repeated this 3 times and then asked him how he liked it. Švejk said that it was better than in the baths near the Charles Bridge, and that he liked bathing very much. "If you'll only cut my nails and my hair too, I'll have everything I need to make me completely happy," he added with a pleasant smile. And this request of his was granted too. And after they had thoroughly rubbed him down with a sponge as well, they wrapped him in a sheet, carried him off to the first ward, put him onto a bed, covered him with a quilt, and asked him to go to sleep. And even today, Švejk talks about it with affection.
"Just imagine, they carried me, really carried me off. I was in a state of utter bliss at that moment."
And indeed, he fell blissfully asleep on the bed. Then they woke him to offer him a mug of milk and a roll. The roll was already cut up into little pieces, and while one of the warders held both his arms, the other dipped the pieces of roll into the milk and fed him like a goose is fed on dumplings. When they had finished feeding him, they took him under the arms and led him off to the WC, where they asked him to perform his large and small bodily needs. And Švejk talks with affection about this lovely moment too, and I certainly do not need to reproduce his words describing what they did with him after that. I will only mention that he said, "One of them held me in his arms while I was doing it." When they brought him back, they put him to bed again and asked him once more to go to sleep. But just as he had dozed off, they woke him up and took him to the examination room where, standing stark naked before 2 doctors, he was reminded of the glorious time when he was called up. The German word tauglich, or fit for service, fell spontaneously from his lips.
"What are you saying?" asked one of the doctors. "Take 5 pieces forward and 5 to the rear."
Švejk took 10.
"But I told you to take 5, said the doctor.
"A few paces more or less are all the same to me," said Švejk. After that, the doctors asked him to sit down on a chair, and one of them tapped him on the knee. Then he said to the other doctor that the reflexes were perfectly correct, whereupon the other shook his head and began to tap Švejk's knee himself, while the first doctor opened wide Švejk's eyelids and examined his pupils. After that, they went away to a table and let fall 1 or 2 expressions in Latin.
Listen, can you sing? One of them asked Švejk. Would you please sing us a song?
With pleasure, gentlemen, Švejk answered. I haven't any voice or musical ear, you know, but I'll have a shot. I'll do it to please you, if you want to be amused. And Švejk struck up. The little monk sat in the chair, and scalding tears ran down his cheeks. Feverishly he tore his hair. I'm afraid I don't know any more, continued Švejk. If you like, I can also sing you, Oh, 'tis heavy on my heart, my bosom heaves with leaden pain, as I sit here and gaze afar, to where I'm bound by love's sweet chain. And I can't remember any more of that either, sighed Švejk. I also note the first verse of Where is My Home, and General Vindish Gretz as the cock did crow, and a few folk songs too, like God Save Our Emperor and Land, When We March to Yaromir, and Hail to the Holy Virgin, Hail a Thousand Times.
The learned doctors exchanged glances, and one of them put the following question to Švejk. Have you ever had your mental condition examined?
In the army, Švejk replied, solemnly and proudly. I was officially certified by military doctors as a patent idiot.
I believe you're a malingerer, the other doctor shouted at Švejk.
What, me, gentlemen? Said Švejk, defending himself. No, I assure you, I'm no malingerer. I'm a genuine idiot.
You only have to ask at Cheska Budijovica,
or at the reserve command at Kalin.
The elder of the two doctors waved his hand in a gesture of despair, and pointing to Švejk, said to the nurses, Give this man back his clothes and send him to the third class in the first corridor. Then one of you come back and take all his papers to the office, and tell them there to settle the case quickly, so that we don't have him round our necks for long. The doctors cast another devastating look at Švejk, who backed deferentially to the door, bowing politely. When one of the nurses asked him what nonsense he was up to now, he answered, As I'm not dressed, I'm naked, and I wouldn't like to show these gentlemen anything in case they should think me rude or vulgar. From the moment the nurses received orders to return Švejk's clothes to him, they no longer showed the slightest concern for him. They told him to get dressed, and one of them took him to the third class, where, during the few days it took the office to complete his discharge formalities, he had an opportunity of carrying on his agreeable observations. The disappointed doctors gave him a certificate that he was a malingerer whose mind was affected. But as they discharged him before he was given any lunch, it led to a minor scene. Švejk declared that if they threw anyone out of a lunatic asylum, they had no right to do so without giving him lunch. This breach of the public peace was stopped by a police officer who had been summoned by the asylum porter and who took Švejk off to the police station in Selmovar Street.
5. Švejk at the police station in Selmovar Street. After Švejk's beautiful sunny days in the asylum came hours full of persecution. Police Inspector Brown set the scene for his meeting with Švejk with all the cruelty of Roman lictors in the time of the charming Emperor Nero. With the same ruthlessness as they said, throw this scoundrel of a Christian to the lions, Inspector Brown said, put him behind bars. Not a word more or less, except that Inspector Brown's eyes shone with a peculiarly perverted lust. Švejk bowed and said proudly, I'm ready, gentlemen. I believe behind bars means the same as a prison cell, and that's not too bad. Don't make yourself too much at home here, answered the police officer, whereupon Švejk piped up, I'm quite modest and grateful for anything you do for me. In the cell, a man was sitting on a plank bed, deep in thought. He sat listlessly, and it was clear from his expression that when the key grated in the lock of the cell, he did not believe that the door would open to set him free. My compliments, Your Honour, said Švejk, sitting down beside him on the plank bed. What time might it be?
Time is not my master, the thoughtful man answered.
It's not too bad here, Švejk continued.
They've at least planed the wood on this plank bed.
The solemn man made no reply. He stood up and began to rush about in the tiny space between the door and the bed, as if he were hurrying to save something. In the meantime, Švejk observed with interest the writings scrawled upon the walls. There was one inscription in which an unknown prisoner solemnly pledged to heaven a fight to the death with the police. It read, "You won't half catch it." Another prisoner had written, "Buzz off, you cops." Another merely recorded the plain fact, "I was locked up here on 5th of June 1913 and wasn't too badly treated. Josef Maracek, tradesman from Vrozvice." And there was another inscription which was earth-shaking in its profundity. "Have mercy, almighty God," and underneath, "Kiss my A." The letter A had been crossed out, however, and instead was written in capitals, "Coattails." Beside it, some poetical soul had written the lines, "I sit in sorrow by the stream, the sun is hid behind the fells. I watch the radiant mountain tops where my best beloved dwells." The man who was rushing between the door and the plank bed as though he was trying to win a marathon race stopped and breathlessly resumed his seat. He plunged his head in his hands and suddenly screamed, "Let me out!"
"No, they won't let me out," he said to himself. "They won't, they won't. I've been here since 6 o'clock this morning."
He then had a fit of expansiveness, stood up erect, and asked Švejk,
"You don't by any chance have a strap on you so that I can end it all?"
"That's something I can very gladly help you with," answered Švejk, undoing his belt. "I've never yet seen anyone hang himself on a strap in a prison cell. Only it's a nuisance that there's no hook here," he went on, looking around him. "The window latch won't bear your weight unless you hang yourself kneeling by the plank bed, like the monk did in the Emmaus monastery when he hanged himself on a crucifix because of a young Jewess. I'm very fond of suicides, so just carry on. Well begun is half done."
The gloomy man, into whose hands Švejk had pushed the strap, gave it one look, threw it into the corner and burst out crying, smearing his tears with his black hands and shrieking out,
"I've got little children. I'm here for drunkenness and immoral practices. My God, my poor wife, what will they say to me in the office? I've got little children. I'm here for drunkenness and immoral practices," etc., etc., ad infinitum.
At last, however, he calmed down a little, went to the door and began to kick it and pound it with his fists. From behind the door could be heard steps and a voice.
"What do you want?"
"Let me out,"
he said in a voice which sounded as if he had nothing left to live for.
"Where to?" came the answer from the other side.
"To my office,"
answered the unfortunate father, official, drunkard and libertine. Laughter could be heard in the quiet of the passage, horrible laughter, and the steps went away again.
"It seems to me that that gentleman must hate you if he laughs at you like that," said Švejk, when the despairing man sat down beside him again. "A policeman like that might do a lot of harm when he gets angry, and when he gets angrier still, he might do anything. Just sit down quietly if you don't want to hang yourself, and wait and see how things develop. If you're an official, you're married, and you have little babes, it's frightful, I must admit. If I'm not mistaken, you're probably convinced that they'll sack you from the office."
"I can't say," he sighed, "because I don't remember myself what I was up to. I only know that I got thrown out from somewhere and that I wanted to get back there to light a cigar. But it started splendidly.
Our departmental chief was celebrating his name day and invited us to a wine restaurant. Then we went to a second, a third, a fourth, a fifth, a sixth, a seventh, an eighth, a ninth."
"Wouldn't you like me to help you, Count?" asked Švejk. "I'm a bit of an expert. One night I was in 28 pubs, but, God's truth, I never had at the most more than 3 glasses of beer in any one of them."
"In short," continued the unfortunate subordinate of the departmental chief who had celebrated his name day in such magnificent style, "when we'd been in about a dozen different night dens, we discovered we'd lost our chief, although we'd tied him with string and led him with us like a little dog. And so we went to look for him everywhere. And finally, we all lost each other,
until in the end I found myself in one of those night cafes in Vinohrady, a very decent place, where I drank a liqueur straight out of the bottle. What I did afterwards, I can't remember. I only know that when they brought me to the police station here, two policemen reported that I was drunk, had been behaving immorally, had hit a lady, taken down somebody else's hat from the peg and cut it in shreds with my penknife, chased away the ladies' orchestra, accused the head waiter in front of everyone of stealing 20 crowns, smashed the marble slab at the table where I was sitting, and intentionally spat into the black coffee of a stranger at the next table. I didn't do anything else. At least, I can't remember having done so. And believe me, I'm a decent, intelligent man who hasn't a thought for anything except his family. What do you say to that? I'm certainly not a hooligan. Švejk made no reply, but asked with interest, "Did you have much trouble smashing that marble slab, or did you do it at one go?"
"At one go," answered the intelligent gentleman.
"Then you're for it," said Švejk, pensively. "They'll prove to you that you coached yourself for it with intensive training. And that stranger's coffee which you spat into, was it with rum or not?" And without waiting for an answer, he explained, "If it was with rum, then it'll be worse for you because it's more expensive. In the court, they reckon up every item and add them together so that it amounts at least to a crime."
"In the court," the conscientious paterfamilias whispered dejectedly,
and hanging his head, lapsed into that unpleasant state in which a man is devoured by the reproaches of his conscience. "And do they know at home that you're in jail?" Švejk asked. "Or will they wait till it's in the paper?"
"Do you think it will be in the paper?"
was the naive question of the victim of the name-day party of his departmental chief. "Why, it's a dead certainty," was the frank answer, for Švejk was never one to conceal anything from others. "All the newspaper readers will get a great kick out of what you did. I also like to read that column about drunks and their escapades. Not long ago, at the pub, the Chalice, one of the guests didn't do anything more than break his own head with a glass. He threw the glass up into the air and then stood underneath it. But they carried him off, and the very next morning we read it in the papers. Or, in Bendlovka, I once slapped an undertaker's mute, and he slapped me back. To restore peace between us, they had to arrest us both, and at once it was in the afternoon paper. Or when that councillor smashed two cups in the cafe, the corpse, do you imagine they spared him? It was immediately in the newspapers the day after. All you can do is to send a correction to the papers from jail saying that the information published about you has nothing to do with you, and that you're no relative of the person of that name and have no connection with him. And you must write home and tell them to cut your correction out of the paper and keep it so that you can read it when you've served out your sentence." "Aren't you cold?" asked Švejk, who was full of compassion when he saw that the intelligent gentleman was shivering. "This year the summer has turned very cold."
"I am done for," sobbed Švejk's companion. "I've lost my promotion now."
"You certainly have," Švejk agreed readily. "And if they don't take you back into the office after you've served out your sentence, I don't know whether you'll find another job so quickly, because anyone at all you wanted to work for, even if it was a skinner, would require from you a certificate of good conduct. No, a moment of debauchery like what you've indulged in costs you dear. And will your wife and children have anything to live on while you're sitting in jail? Or will she have to go and beg and teach the babes all sorts of vices?" A sob could be heard.
"My poor little babes! My poor wife!"
The conscienceless penitent stood up and started talking about his babes. He had 5. The eldest was 12 and was one of those scouts. He only drank water and ought to have been an example to his father, who had misbehaved like this for the first time in his life.
"A scout!" exclaimed Švejk. "I like hearing about those scouts. Once, in Midlovery, near Zvliv, district Klubovka, police district Česka Budijovica, just when we of the 91st were doing our training.
the peasants from the neighbourhood started a hunt for scouts who were swarming in the parish wood. They caught three of them. When they tied up the smallest of them, he moaned, squealed, and wailed so much that we hardened soldiers could not bear the sight of it and thought it better to clear off. While these three scouts were being tied up, they bit eight peasants. Afterwards, under the torture of the birch, they confessed before the mayor that there wasn't a single meadow in the region they hadn't flattened out while they lay sunbathing. And then again they said that it was only by pure accident that the field of standing corn near Ajice burnt down. It was just before the harvest, and they only happened to be roasting a deer on a spit in the middle of it, one they'd stalked and killed with their knives in the parish wood. In their hideout in the wood were found more than half a hundredweight of gnawed bones of poultry and game, an enormous quantity of cherry stones, heaps of cores of unripe apples, and other good things.
The scout's poor father was not to be comforted, however.
"What have I done?"
he wailed.
"My reputation is ruined."
"It certainly is," said Švejk with his characteristic frankness. "After all you've done, your reputation will certainly be ruined for life. When your friends have read all about it in the newspapers, they'll certainly add something to it of their own. They always do that, but don't be worried about it. There are 10 times more people in the world with blemished reputations than there are with unblemished ones. That's just a very unimportant trifle."
In the passage, energetic steps could be heard. The key grated in the lock, the door opened, and a policeman called Švejk's name.
"Excuse me," said Švejk, chivalrously. "I've only been here since 12 noon, but this gentleman has been here since 6 o'clock this morning. I'm not in any hurry anyway."
Instead of getting an answer, Švejk was dragged into the passage by the powerful arm of a policeman and silently led up the stairs to the first floor. In the second room, a police inspector was sitting at a table. He was a fat gentleman of amiable countenance and said to Švejk,
"So you're this Švejk, then. And how did you get here?"
"The most common or garden way in the world," answered Švejk. "I came here under the escort of a police officer because I wasn't going to put up with them throwing me out of the lunatic asylum without any lunch. It was as though they took me for a kicked-out whore."
"All right, Švejk," said the inspector, affably. "Why should we have to be bothered with you here at Salmavar Street? Wouldn't it be better to send you to police headquarters?"
"You're master of the situation, as the saying goes," said Švejk with composure. "A walk to police headquarters now in the evening would be quite a pleasant little stroll."
"I'm glad that we agree about that," said the inspector, cheerfully. "Much better when we agree, isn't it, Švejk?"
"And I'm always awfully glad to take advice from anyone, too," replied Švejk. "I'll never forget your kindness to me, Inspector. Believe me, I won't."
Bowing deferentially, he went down to the guardroom accompanied by the police officer, and a quarter of an hour later could be seen at the corner of Yechna Street and Charles Square, under the escort of another police officer, who was carrying under his arm a voluminous book of prisoners' records with the German title Arrestantenbuch. At the corner of Spalena Street, Švejk and his escort met a crowd of people who were surging round a placard that had been hung up.
"That's His Imperial Majesty's proclamation on the declaration of war," said the police officer to Švejk.
"I prophesied it," said Švejk, "but in the lunatic asylum, they still don't know about it, although they should have got it from the horse's mouth."
"What do you mean?"
the police officer asked Švejk.
"Because they've got a lot of officer gentlemen locked up there," Švejk explained.
And when they reached another crowd of people surging in front of the proclamation, Švejk shouted out,
"God save our Emperor Franz Josef! We shall win this war!"
Someone in the enthusiastic crowd banged his hat over his ears, and so the good soldier Švejk, surrounded by a crowd of people, stepped once more through the gates of police headquarters.
"Quite definitely we'll win this war. I repeat it once more, gentlemen."
And with these words, Švejk took leave of the crowd which accompanied him. And somewhere from the dim ages of history, the truth dawned upon Europe that the morrow would obliterate the plans of today. 6. Švejk home again after having broken through the vicious circle. The spirit of alien authority pervaded the building of the police headquarters, an authority which was ascertaining how enthusiastic the population were for the war. With the exception of a few people who were ready to admit that they were sons of a nation which had to bleed for interests completely alien to it, police headquarters presented the finest collection of bureaucratical beasts of prey to whom jails and gallows were the only means of defending the existence of the twisted clauses of the law. They treated their victims with malicious affability, weighing every word carefully in advance. "I am very sorry that you've fallen into our hands again," said one of these black and yellow striped vultures when they brought Švejk before him. "We thought that you had reform, but we've been disappointed." Švejk mutely nodded his head and assumed so innocent an expression that the black and yellow vulture looked at him inquiringly and said emphatically, "Take that imbecile expression off your face." But he immediately went over to an amiable tone and continued, "Of course, it's very disagreeable for us to keep you in custody, and I can assure you that, in my opinion, your guilt can't be so enormous. With your absence of intelligence, you must obviously have been led astray. Tell me, Mr. Švejk, who was it really who led you to commit such stupidities?" Švejk coughed and replied, "Oh, begging your pardon, sir, I know nothing of any stupidities."
"But wasn't it stupidity, Mr. Švejk?" he said in an artificially paternal tone, "when, according to the deposition of the police officer who brought you here, you caused a crowd of people to collect in front of the war proclamation which was posted up at the corner, and you incited people with shouts of 'God save our Emperor Franz Josef! This war is already won!'"
"I couldn't hang back," declared Švejk, fixing his honest eyes on the eyes of the Inquisitor. "I was so angry when I saw how they were all reading this proclamation and none of them were expressing any joy. There were no shouts of 'God save our Emperor,' no hurrahs, nothing at all, Inspector. It was just as if they didn't care. An old soldier of the 91st Regiment like me couldn't go on looking at it, and so I shouted out those words. And I believe that had you been in my place, you'd have done exactly the same as I did. If there's a war, it must be won, and people must call out 'God save our Emperor.' No one will talk me out of that."
Crushed and overcome, the black and yellow wolf could not withstand the gaze of the pure and innocent lamb, Švejk. He lowered his gaze onto the official documents and said,
"I give you full marks for your enthusiasm, but if only it had been displayed in different circumstances. After all, you know very well that you were under police escort, and that a patriotic pronouncement like that could and must have been regarded by the public as ironic rather than serious."
"When a chap is being led under police escort," answered Švejk, "it's a very hard moment in his life. And if a man, even in such a difficult moment as that, doesn't forget what he ought to do when there's a war on, I think he's not so bad after all." The black and yellow wolf growled and looked Švejk in the eyes once more. Švejk parried with the innocent, gentle, modest and tender warmth of his gaze. For a moment they both went on staring fixedly at each other.
"Go to hell, Švejk," said the official at last. "And if you ever come here again, I shan't ask you any questions but march you straight off to the military court at Hradčany. Do you understand?"
But before he could say Jack Robinson, Švejk had stepped towards him, kissed his hand, and said, "May the good Lord reward you for everything. If at any time you should need a thoroughbred little dog, just ask me. I deal in dogs." And so Švejk found himself at liberty again and on his way home. He could not make up his mind whether he should stop first at the chalice. Finally, he decided he would, and opened the door through which he had gone out some time ago under the escort of Detective Brettschneider. A deathly silence reigned in the bar. A few guests sat there, including the sexton from St. Apollinaire. They looked very gloomy. Behind the serving counter sat Mrs. Palevich and stared dully at the beer taps.
"Well, here I am back again," said Švejk gaily. "May I have a glass of beer, please?" "What's happened to Mr. Palevich? Is he home again, too?"
Instead of replying, Mrs. Palevich burst into tears, and concentrating all her misery onto a special stress on every word, groaned out,
"A week ago he got 10 years.
"There you are, then," said Švejk. "So he's already served 7 days of it."
"He was always so careful,"
sobbed Mrs. Palevich.
"He always said that about himself."
The customers in the bar maintained a stubborn silence, as though the spirit of Palevich was haunting the room and urging them to even greater caution.
"Caution is the mother of wisdom," said Švejk, sitting down at a table to a glass of beer.
In the foam there were little holes made by Mrs. Palevich's tears as they fell into it when she brought the glass to the table for Švejk.
"We're living in such times that we are forced to be cautious."
"Yesterday we had 2 funerals,
said the sexton of St. Apollinaire, changing the subject.
"That means somebody must have died," said another customer.
Whereupon a third added,
"Were they funerals with a catafalque?" "I'd like to know," said Švejk, "what military funerals are going to be like now there's a war on."
The customers rose, paid, and went out noiselessly. Švejk was left alone with Mrs. Palevich.
"I never imagined that they'd sentence an innocent man to 10 years, he said. "Sentencing an innocent man to 5 years, that's something I've heard of, but 10, that's a bit too much."
"Well, you see, he confessed everything, my old man,"
sobbed Mrs. Palevich.
"What he was saying here about those flies and that picture, he repeated at police headquarters and before the court.
I was a witness at the trial. But what evidence could I give when they told me that as I was in a state of relations with my husband, I could forego giving evidence? I was so scared of that state of relations, in case it might lead to something else, that I got out of giving evidence, and he, poor dear, gave me such a look. I shall never forget that look to my dying day. And after the sentence had been passed and they were leading him off, he shouted to them in the passage as though he'd gone off his head, 'Long live free thinking!'" "And Mr. Brettschneider doesn't come here any more?" asked Švejk.
"He's been here several times," answered Mrs. Palevich. "He drank a beer or two, asked me who comes here, and listened to the customers talking about football. As soon as they catch sight of him, they start talking about nothing else but football. And he had the jerks as though any moment he'd go mad and have a fit. And all that time he only succeeded in catching an upholsterer from Pritchnar Street."
"It's all a matter of training," observed Švejk. "Was that upholsterer a stupid fellow?"
"Rather like my husband," she replied, weeping. "Mr. Brettschneider asked him if he would fire against the Serbs, and he said he couldn't shoot, that he was once at the shooting range and shot through a whole crown. Then we all heard how Mr. Brettschneider took out his notebook and said, 'Aha, and here's another nice case of treason.' And he went away with that upholsterer from Pritchnar Street, who never came back."
"Lots of them never come back," said Švejk. "Can I have a rum, please?"
Švejk was just having a second glass of rum when Brettschneider came into the bar. Throwing a quick glance at the bar and the empty rooms, he sat down next to Švejk and, ordering a beer, waited to see what he would say. Švejk took down a newspaper from the hanger and, looking at the last page of advertisement, said,
"Well, I never, look at that. A Mr. Chimpera of Shrazkov No. 5 near Achinevis is selling a farm with 9 acres of land convenient for school and railway station."
Brettschneider drummed his fingers nervously and, turning to Švejk, said,
I'm surprised that you're interested in farming, Mr. Švejk.
Oh, it's you, is it? Said Švejk, shaking his hand. I couldn't recognise you at first. I have a very bad memory. The last time we parted, if I remember aright, was in the reception office at police headquarters. What have you been doing since then? Do you come here often?
I've come here today because of you, said Brettschneider. I was told at police headquarters that you sell dogs. I need a nice miniature pincher or a pom or something of that kind.
I can get any for you, replied Švejk. Do you want a thoroughbred animal or a common cur?
I think I'll plump for a thoroughbred, replied Brettschneider.
And why don't you have a police dog? Asked Švejk. Wouldn't you like one that picks up the scent at once and leads you to the scene of the crime? There's a butcher in Vrasovice who has one, and he uses it for drawing his cart. You might very well say that that dog has missed its vocation.
I should like a pom, said Brettschneider with quiet obstinacy. A pom that doesn't bite.
Do you want a pom without teeth, then? Asked Švejk. I know of one. It belongs to a pub keeper in Dejfice.
Then I'd rather have a miniature pincher, replied Brettschneider, whose sinological capacities were very elementary, and who would never have learnt anything about dogs at all if he'd not got those orders from police headquarters. But the instructions were precise, clear, and firm. To get on to familiar terms with Švejk on the basis of his dog dealing, for which purpose he had the right to choose assistance and dispose of funds for the purchase of dogs.
There are bigger and smaller miniature pinchers, said Švejk. I know of two small ones and three big ones. You can nurse all five of them on your lap. I can recommend them to you very warmly.
That's what I'd like, said Brettschneider. And how much would it be if I only took one?
It goes by sizes, answered Švejk. It depends on the size, you see. A miniature pincher's not a calf. With miniature pinchers, it's just the opposite. The smaller they are, the dearer they come.
I'm considering getting larger ones, which would be good watchdogs, answered Brettschneider, who was beginning to fear that he might overburden the secret funds of the state police.
All right, then, said Švejk. I can sell you the bigger ones for 50 crowns and bigger ones still for 45 crowns. But we've forgotten one thing. Are they to be puppies or grown dogs, dogs or bitches?
It's all the same to me, answered Brettschneider, who was here on unfamiliar ground. Get them for me and I'll come and fetch them tomorrow at 7 o'clock in the evening. Is that all right?
Come along and it'll be all right, answered Švejk dryly. But in this case I must ask you for a deposit of 30 crowns.
By all means, said Brettschneider, paying out the money. And now let's have a quarter litre of wine on me.
When they had drunk it up, Švejk stood Brettschneider another quarter, and then Brettschneider invited Švejk not to be afraid of him, saying that today he was not on duty, and that it was all right to speak to him about politics. Švejk declared that he never spoke about politics in a pub, that politics in general were only for babies. Brettschneider's views were, on the contrary, more revolutionary. He said that every weak state was doomed to extinction, and asked Švejk what were his views on this subject. Švejk said that he had nothing to do with the state, but that he had once had to look after a St. Bernard puppy in a weak state. He'd fed it on army biscuits, but it had pegged out all the same. When each of them had had a fifth quarter litre, Brettschneider declared that he was an anarchist and asked Švejk what organisation he would recommend him to join. Švejk said that an anarchist once purchased from him a Leonberger dog for 100 crowns and never paid him the last instalment. During the sixth quarter litre, Brettschneider talked about revolution and against mobilisation, whereupon Švejk leant towards him and whispered in his ear,
"A customer's just come in. Be careful he doesn't hear you, otherwise you might be in trouble. You see, the landlord's wife's already in tears."
Mrs. Palevich was indeed crying on her chair behind the service counter.
"What are you crying for, Mrs. Pelevich?" asked Brett Schneider. "In 3 months' time we'll have won the war, there'll be an amnesty, your husband'll return, and then we'll have a fine celebration." "Or don't you think that we shall win?" he asked, turning to Švejk.
"Why keep on always playing that gramophone record?" said Švejk. "We've got to win, and that's that. And now I must go home."
Švejk paid his bill and returned to his old charwoman, Mrs. Müller, who was scared when she realized that the man who was opening the door of the flat with his latchkey was Švejk.
"Oh, Lord, sir, I thought you wouldn't be returning here for many years," she said with her usual frankness. "And so in the meanwhile, out of charity, I took a porter from a nightclub as a lodger, because we've had a police search here 3 times, and when they couldn't find anything, they said it was all up with you, because you were so cunning."
Švejk was at once able to convince himself that the unknown lodger had made himself very much at home. He was sleeping in his bed, and was indeed so noble as to be content with only half of it, having placed in the other half a long-haired creature who gratefully slept, embracing him round the neck, while articles of male and female attire were scattered higgledy-piggledy round the bed. From this chaos, it was evident that the nightclub porter had returned with his lady in a jocund mood.
"Sir," said Švejk, shaking the intruder, "make sure that you're not late for lunch. I should hate it if you had to say that I'd thrown you out after you'd lost your chance of getting any lunch."
The porter from the nightclub was very sleepy, and it took a long time before he understood that the owner of the bed had returned home and was making a claim to it. Like all nightclub porters, this gentleman declared that he would smash anyone who woke him up and tried to go on sleeping. In the meantime, Švejk collected parts of his clothing, brought them to his bed, and shaking him energetically, said,
"If you don't dress, I'll try to fling you out just as you are onto the street. It'll be a great advantage for you if you're properly dressed when you fly out."
"I wanted to sleep until 8 o'clock in the evening," said the porter in a startled voice as he put on his pants. "I'm paying the mistress 2 crowns a day for the bed, and I'm allowed to bring here young ladies from the club. Marenya, get up!"
As he was putting on his collar and tying his tie, he recovered sufficiently to be able to assure Švejk that the nightclub Mimosa was really one of the most respectable nightclubs, and that ladies were only admitted there who had a clean police book, and he cordially invited Švejk to come and visit it. On the other hand, his female companion was not at all pleased with Švejk and used some very choice expressions, of which the choicest of all was,
"You son of an archbishop, you!"
After the departure of the intruders, Švejk went to settle accounts with Mrs. Müller, but found no trace of her except for a scrap of paper, upon which, with unusual ease in her scrawly handwriting, she had recorded her thoughts about the unfortunate episode of the loan of Švejk's bed to the porter from the nightclub.
"Excuse me, sir, if I don't see you any more, because I am going to jump out the window."
"She's lying," said Švejk, and waited. Half an hour later, the unfortunate Mrs. Müller crept into the kitchen, and it was clear from her distraught expression that she was expecting words of consolation from Švejk.
"If you want to jump out the window," said Švejk, "go into the sitting room. I've opened the window for you. I wouldn't advise you to jump out of the kitchen window, because you'd fall onto the rose bed in the garden, damage the bushes, and have to pay for them. From the window of the sitting room, you'll fall beautifully onto the pavement, and if you're lucky, you'll break your neck. If not, you'll only break all your ribs, arms, and legs, and you'll have to pay for hospital charges."
Mrs. Müller burst into tears, went quietly into the sitting room, and shut the window. Then coming back, she said,
"It's terribly draughty there, and it wouldn't be good for your rheumatism, sir."
Then she went to make the bed, put it all in order with unusual care, and, returning to Švejk in the kitchen, remarked with tears in her eyes,
"Those 2 puppies, sir, which we had in the courtyard are pegged out, and that St. Bernard, it ran away when the police made their search.
Oh, my God! Shouted Švejk. He'll get himself into a fine mess. The police will be after him soon.
He bit one police inspector when they pulled him out from underneath the bed during the search, continued Mrs. Müller. Before that, one of those gentlemen said that there was somebody under the bed, and so they called that St. Bernard to come out in the name of the law, and when he wouldn't, they dragged him out, and he was going to gobble them up. But then he bolted out of the door and never returned. They also cross-questioned me about who comes to see us, whether we get any money from abroad, and then they started insinuating that I was a fool when I told them that we only get money from abroad very rarely, the last being from the headmaster in Bruno, that advance of 60 crowns for an Angora cat which you advertised in Narodny Politica, and instead of which you sent him that blind fox terrier puppy in a date box. After that, they talked to me very affably and recommended me that porter from the nightclub so that I shouldn't be afraid of being alone in the flat, that very man you just thrown out. I've always had bad luck with those authorities, Mrs. Müller. Now you'll see how many of them are going to come here to buy dogs, sighed Švejk. I don't know whether those gentlemen who examined the police archives after the overthrow of the Austro-Hungarian monarchy succeeded in deciphering the items of the secret funds of the state police where it was written B, 40 crowns, F, 50 crowns, L, 80 crowns, etc. But they certainly were deceived if they thought that B, F, L were the initials of any gentleman who for 40, 50, 80, etc. crowns sold the Czech nation to the black and yellow eagle. B stands for St. Bernard, F for Fox Terrier, and L for Leonberger. All these dogs Rettschneider took from Švejk to police headquarters. They were ghastly mongrels, which had no connection whatsoever with any thoroughbred race which Švejk pretended them to be when he sold them to Rettschneider. The St. Bernard was a mixture of mongrel poodle and a common street cur. The fox terrier had the ears of a dachshund and was the size of a butcher's dog, with bandy legs as though it had suffered from rickets. The head of the Leonberger recalled the hairy muzzle of a stable pincher. It had a stubbed tail, was the height of a dachshund, and had bare hindquarters like the famous naked American dogs. Later, Detective Kalos came to buy a dog, and returned with a wildly staring monster, which was reminiscent of a spotted hyena with the mane of a collie, and in the accounts of the secret fund came a new item, M, 90 crowns. The monster was passing itself off as a mastiff. But not even Kalos succeeded in getting any information out of Švejk. He fared the same as Rettschneider. Švejk diverted the deftest political conversations to the curing of distemper in puppies, and the most cunningly prepared traps always ended in Rettschneider bringing back from Švejk another unbelievable mongrel monster. And that was the end of the famous detective Rettschneider. When he had seven monsters of this kind in his flat, he shut himself up with them in the back room and starved them so long that they finally gobbled him up. He was so honourable that he saved the state the expense of a funeral. In his personal file at police headquarters, there were recorded under the column Advancement in Service the following poignant words, devoured by his own dogs. When Švejk learnt later about this tragic event, he said, "It gives me a headache to think how they're going to put all his pieces together when the day of the last judgment comes." 7. Švejk goes to the war. At the time when the forests on the River Raab in Galicia saw the Austrian armies fleeing across the river, and when down in Serbia one after the other of the Austrian divisions were taken with their pants down and got the walloping they had long deserved, the Austrian Ministry of War suddenly remembered Švejk. Why, even he might help to get the monarchy out of the mess.
When they brought Švejk the order to report within a week for a medical examination on Strelecki Ostrov, he happened to be lying in bed, stricken once more by rheumatism. Mrs. Muller was making coffee for him in the kitchen.
"Mrs. Muller?" Švejk called softly from his room. "Mrs. Muller? Come here for a moment."
When the charwoman stood by his bed, Švejk repeated in the same soft voice, "Sit down, Mrs. Muller." There was something mysterious and solemn in his voice. When she had sat down, Švejk drew himself up in bed and announced,
"I'm going to the war."
"Holy Mother!"
shrieked Mrs. Muller.
"Whatever are you going to do there?"
"Fight,"
answered Švejk in sepulchral tones.
"Things are going very badly for Austria. Up above, they're already creeping on us at Krakow, and down below, on Hungary. They're crushing us like a steamroller on all sides, and that's why they're calling me up. I read you yesterday from the newspaper, didn't I, that dark clouds were enveloping our dear fatherland."
"But you can't move."
"That doesn't matter, Mrs. Muller. I shall go to the war in a bath chair. You know that confectioner round the corner? Well, he has just the right kind of bath chair. Years ago, he used to push his lame and wicked old grandfather about it in the fresh air. Mrs. Muller, you're going to push me to the war in that bath chair."
Mrs. Muller burst into tears.
"Oh, dear, sir, shouldn't I run for the doctor?"
"You'll not run anywhere, Mrs. Muller. Except for my legs, I'm completely sound cannon fodder, and at a time when things are going badly for Austria, every cripple must be at his post. Just go on making the coffee."
And while Mrs. Muller, tear-stained and distraught, poured the coffee through the strainer, the good soldier Švejk started singing in bed.
"General Windischgratz, as the cock did crow, unfurled his banner and charged the foe. Rataplan, rataplan, rataplan. Charged the foe and brandished his sword, calling to Mary, Mother of the Lord, rataplan, rataplan, rataplan."
The panic-stricken Mrs. Muller, under the impact of this awe-inspiring war song, forgot about the coffee, and trembling in every limb, listened in horror as the good soldier Švejk continued to sing in bed, "With Mary, Mother, and bridges for Piedmont, strengthen your posts for war, rataplan, rataplan, rataplan. At Solferino there was battle and slaughter, piles of corpses and blood like water, rataplan, rataplan, rataplan. Arms and legs flying in the air, for the brave 18th were fighting there, rataplan, rataplan, rataplan. Boys of the 18th, don't lose heart. There's money behind in the baggage cart, rataplan, rataplan, rataplan."
"For God's sake, sir, please,"
came the piteous voice from the kitchen. But Švejk was already ending his war song.
"Money in the cart and wenches in the van. What a life for a military man, rataplan, rataplan, rataplan."
Mrs. Muller burst out of the door and rushed for the doctor. She returned in an hour's time while Švejk had slumbered off, and so he was woken up by a corpulent gentleman who laid his hand on his forehead for a moment and said,
"Don't be afraid. I am Dr. Pavik from Vinoradi. Let me feel your pulse. Put this thermometer under your armpit. Good. Now show me your tongue. A bit more. Keep it out. What did your father and mother die of?"
And so, at a time when it was Vienna's earnest desire that all the peoples of Austria-Hungary should offer the finest examples of loyalty and devotion, Dr. Pavek prescribed Švejk bromide against his patriotic enthusiasm and recommended the brave and good soldier not to think about the war.
"Lie straight and keep quiet. I'll come again tomorrow."
When he came the next day, he asked Mrs. Muller in the kitchen how the patient was.
"He's worse, doctor,"
she answered with genuine grief.
"In the night, he was singing, if you'll pardon the expression, the Austrian national anthem when the rheumatism suddenly took him."
Dr. Pavek felt obliged to react to this new manifestation of loyalty on the part of his patient by prescribing a larger dose of bromide.
The third day, Mrs. Müller informed him that Švejk had got even worse.
In the afternoon, he sent for a map of the battlefield, doctor, and in the night, he was seized by a mad hallucination that Austria was going to win.
And he takes his powders strictly according to the prescription?
Oh, no, doctor. He hasn't even sent for them yet.
Dr. Pavek went away after having called down a storm of reproaches on Švejk's head and assured him that he would never again come to cure anybody who refused his professional help and bromide. Only 2 days remained before Švejk would have to appear before the call-up board. During this time, Švejk made the necessary preparations. First he sent Mrs. Müller to buy an army cap, and next he sent her to borrow the bath chair from the confectioner around the corner. That same one in which the confectioner once used to wheel about in the fresh air his lame and wicked old grandfather. Then he remembered he needed crutches. Fortunately, the confectioner still kept the crutches, too, as a family relic of his old grandfather. Now he only needed the recruit's bunch of flowers for his buttonhole. Mrs. Müller got these for him, too. During these last 2 days, she got noticeably thinner and wept from morning to night. And so on that memorable day there appeared on the Prague streets a moving example of loyalty. An old woman pushing before her a bath chair in which there sat a man in an army cap with a finely polished imperial badge and waving his crutches. And in his buttonhole there shone the gay flowers of a recruit. And this man, waving his crutches again and again, shouted out to the streets of Prague, "To Belgrade! To Belgrade!" He was followed by a crowd of people which steadily grew from the small group that had gathered in front of the house from which he had gone out to war. Švejk could see that the policemen standing at some of the crossroads saluted him. At Wenceslas Square, the crowd around Švejk's bath chair had grown by several hundreds, and at the corner of Krakowska Street, they beat up a student in a German cap who had shouted out to Švejk, "Heil! Nieder mit den Serben!" Down with the Serbs. At the corner of Vodikova Street, mounted police rode in and dispersed the crowd. When Švejk showed the district police inspector that he had it in black and white that he must that day appear before the call-up board, the latter was a trifle disappointed. And in order to reduce disturbances to a minimum, he had Švejk and his bath chair escorted by two mounted police all the way to the Strelecki Ostrov. The following article about this episode appeared in the Prague Official News. A Cripple's Patriotism. Yesterday afternoon, the passers-by in the main streets of Prague were witnesses of a scene which was an eloquent testimony to the fact that in these great and solemn hours, the sons of our nation can furnish the finest examples of loyalty and devotion to the throne of the aged monarch. We might well have been back in the times of the ancient Greeks and Romans, when Mucius Scaevola had himself led off to battle, regardless of his burnt arm. The most sacred feelings and sympathies were nobly demonstrated yesterday by a cripple on crutches who was pushed in an invalid chair by his aged mother. This son of the Czech people, spontaneously and regardless of his infirmity, had himself driven off to war to sacrifice his life and possessions for his emperor. And if his call to Belgrade found such a lively echo on the streets of Prague, it only goes to prove what model examples of love for the fatherland and the imperial house are proffered by the people of Prague. The Praga Tagblatt wrote in the same strain, ending its article by saying that the cripple volunteer was escorted by a crowd of Germans who protected him with their bodies from lynching by the Czech agents of the Entente. Bohemi published the same report and urged that the patriotic cripple should be fittingly rewarded. It announced that at its offices it was ready to receive gifts from German citizens for the unknown hero. If, in the eyes of these three journals, the Czech lands could not have produced a nobler citizen, this was not the opinion of the gentleman at the call-up board, certainly not of the chief army doctor, Bautzer, an utterly ruthless man who saw in everything a criminal attempt to evade military service, the front, bullets and shrapnel. This German's stock remark was widely famous.
The whole Czech people are nothing but a pack of malingerers.
During the 10 weeks of his activities, of 11,000 civilians, he cleaned out 10,999 malingerers, and he would certainly have got the 11,000th by the throat if it had not happened that just when he shouted about turn, the unfortunate man was carried off by a stroke.
"Take away that malingerer," said Bautzer,
when he had ascertained that the man was dead. And on that memorable day, it was Švejk who stood before him. Like the others, he was stark naked and chastely hid his nudity behind the crutches on which he supported himself.
"That's really a remarkable fig leaf," said Bautzer in German. "There were no fig leaves like that in paradise."
"Certified as totally unfit for service on grounds of idiocy," observed the sergeant major, looking at the official documents.
"And what else is wrong with you?" asked Bautzer. "Humbly report, sir, I'm a rheumatic, but I will serve His Imperial Majesty to my last drop of blood," said Švejk, modestly. "I have swollen knees."
Bautzer gave the good soldier Švejk a blood-curdling look and roared out in German,
"You're a malingerer!"
Turning to the sergeant major, he said with icy calm,
"Clip the bastard into jail at once."
Two soldiers with bayonets took Švejk off to the garrison jail. Švejk walked on his crutches and observed with horror that his rheumatism was beginning to disappear. Mrs. Müller was still waiting for Švejk with the bath chair above on the bridge, but when she saw him under bayoneted escort, she burst into tears and ran away from the bath chair, never to return to it again. And the good soldier Švejk walked along unassumingly under the escort of the armed protectors of the state. Their bayonets shone in the light of the sun, and at Malostrana, before the monument of Radetzky, Švejk turned to the crowd which had followed them and called out,
"To Belgrade! To Belgrade!"
And Marshal Radetzky looked dreamily down from his monument at the good soldier Švejk as, limping on his old crutches, he slowly disappeared into the distance with his recruit's flowers in his buttonhole. Meanwhile, a solemn-looking gentleman informed the crowd around that it was a dissenter they were leading off. 8. Švejk the Malingerer. In these great times, the army doctors took unusual pains to drive the devil of sabotage out of the malingerers and restore them to the bosom of the army. Various degrees of torture had been introduced for malingerers and suspected malingerers, such as consumptives, rheumatics, people with hernia, kidney disease, typhus, diabetes, pneumonia, and other illnesses. The tortures to which the malingerers were subjected were systematized, and the grades were as follows. 1. Strict diet, a cup of tea each morning and evening for 3 days, during which, irrespective, of course, of their complaints, aspirin to be given to induce sweating. 2. To ensure they did not think that war was all beer and skittles, quinine in powder to be served in generous portions, or so-called quinine licking. 3. The stomach to be pumped out twice a day with a litre of warm water. 4. Enemas with soapy water and glycerine to be applied. 5. Wrapping up in a sheet soaked in cold water. There were stalwart men who endured all 5 degrees of torture and let themselves be carried off to the military cemetery in a simple coffin. But there were also pusillanimous souls who, when they reached the stage of the enema, declared that they were now well and desired nothing better than to march off to the trenches with the next march battalion. In the garrison prison, Švejk was put into the sanatorium hut among pusillanimous malingerers of this very type.
"I can't stand it any longer,"
said his neighbour in the next bed, who was brought in from the consulting room after having had his stomach pumped for the second time. This man was shamming short-sightedness.
"Tomorrow, I'll join the regiment," decided his other neighbour on the left, who had just had an enema and who had been shamming deafness.
In the bed by the door, a consumptive who was wrapped up in a cold, wet sheet was slowly dying.
"That's the third this week," observed his neighbour on the right. "And what's your trouble?"
"I've got rheumatism," answered Švejk, upon which there was a hearty guffaw all round. Even the dying consumptive, who was shamming tuberculosis, joined in the laughter.
"Don't try and climb in here with rheumatism," a fat man warned Švejk solemnly. "Rheumatism here doesn't mean more than a chilblain. I'm anemic. I've lost half my stomach and five of my ribs, but no one believes me. We even had a fellow here who was deaf and dumb. For a fortnight they wrapped him up every half hour in a cold, wet sheet, and every day they gave him an enema and pumped his stomach. All the nurses thought he'd won through and would go home when the doctor prescribed him an emetic. It could have torn him in half, and so he lost courage. 'I can't go on being deaf and dumb,' he said. 'My speech and hearing have returned.' All the patients urged him not to ruin himself, but he insisted that he could hear and speak just like other people. And he reported to this effect at the doctor's visit next morning."
"He kept it up for quite a long time," remarked a man who was pretending to have one leg 4 inches shorter than the other. "Not like that chap who shammed a stroke. All they had to do was give him 3 doses of quinine, 1 enema and a day's fasting.
He confessed, and by the time they started pumping out his stomach, there wasn't a trace left of his stroke."
The chap who held out longest of all was the one who had been bitten by a mad dog. He bit. He howled. It's true, he could do it splendidly, but he just couldn't manage to foam at the mouth.
"We did our best to help him. Several times we tickled him for a whole hour before the doctor's visit until he had convulsions and got blue all over, but the foam wouldn't come and didn't, in fact, come at all. It was really terrifying. When he gave in one morning at the doctor's visit, we were quite sorry for him. He stood by his bed, erect as a candle, saluted and said, 'Humbly report, sir, the dog I was bitten by may not have been mad after all.' The doctor gave him such a queer look that he began to tremble all over and went on, 'Humbly report, sir, I wasn't bitten by a dog at all. It was I who bit myself in the arm.'
After that confession, they put him under investigation for self-mutilation on the charge that he'd tried to bite off his arm to get out of going to the front."
"All those kind of illnesses where you have to foam at the mouth are difficult to sham," said the fat malingerer. "Take, for instance, epilepsy. We had an epileptic here who always used to tell us that one fit wasn't enough, so he put on some 10 a day. He writhed in convulsions, clenched his fists, rolled his eyes wildly, flung himself about on the floor, stuck out his tongue. In short, I can tell you, it was a magnificent first-class epilepsy, the genuine thing. But suddenly he got boils, 2 on the neck and 2 on the back, and it was all over with his writhing and flinging himself about on the floor when he couldn't move his head and wasn't able either to sit or lie down. He got fever, and in delirium he let out everything at the doctor's visit. He gave us a lot of trouble over his boils, because he had to lie here with them another 3 days and got another diet, coffee and rolls in the morning, soup, dumplings and gravy for lunch, and porridge or soup in the evening. And with our hungry, pumped-out stomachs and strict diet, we had to watch this fellow bolting the food, smacking his lips, panting and belching with repletion. In this way he broke down another 3 who confessed as well. They had been suffering from heart disease."
"The best thing to sham," said one of the malingerers, "is insanity. There are 2 of our teachers lying in the ward next door, and one of them shrieks out incessantly, day and night, 'Giordano Bruno's stake is still smouldering. Reopen the trial of Galileo.' And the other one barks, first 3 times slowly, 'Bow, wow, wow,' then 5 times quickly in succession, 'Bow, wow, 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 wow,' and then once more, slowly, and so it goes on without a break. They've managed to keep it up for over 3 weeks now. Originally,
And I wanted to be insane, too, of religious mania and preach about papal infallibility. But in the end, I fixed myself up with cancer of the stomach from a barber in Malastrana for 15 crowns.
On our chimney sweep in Brevnov, remarked another patient, for 10 crowns, he'll give you such a fever that you'll jump out the window.
That's nothing, said another. In Vrsovice, there's a midwife who, for 20 crowns, will dislocate your leg so well that you'll be a cripple until your death.
I had my leg dislocated for 10 crowns, came a voice from the row of beds by the window. For 10 crowns and 3 glasses of beer.
My illness has cost me more than 200 already, answered his neighbour, a dried-up stick. You tell me any poison I haven't taken, you won't find it. I'm a living repository of poisons of all kinds. I've taken mercury, chloride, I've breathed in mercury fumes, I've chewed arsenic, I've smoked opium, I've drunk tincture of opium, I've sprinkled morphine on bread, I've swallowed strychnine, I've drunk a solution of phosphorus in carbon sulphide as well as picric acid. I've destroyed my liver, my lungs, my kidneys, my gallbladder, my brain, my heart and my intestines. No one knows what kind of illness I have.
Best thing to do, explained somebody from the door, is to inject paraffin under the skin of your arm. My cousin was so fortunate as to have his arm cut off under the elbow, and today he has no trouble for the rest of the war.
So, you see, said Švejk, everyone has to go through all that for His Imperial Majesty, even stomach pumping and enemas. When I served years ago in my regiment, it was even worse. In those days, they used to truss the patient and throw him into a hole to recuperate him. There weren't any bunks like there are here, or spittoons either. Just a bare plank bed, and the patients lay on it. Once, one had a genuine typhus, and the other next to him had smallpox. Both were trussed, and the regimental doctor kicked them in the belly for being malingerers. And when both these soldiers died, it came up in Parliament and was in the newspapers. They immediately forbade us to read those newspapers and searched our boxes in case we had them. And as I always have bad luck, I was the only one in the whole regiment they found them on. So I was taken off on regimental report, and our colonel, who was a bloody half-wit, God help him, started to roar at me to stand straight and to tell him who it was who wrote that in the newspapers, or he'd break my jaw wide open and have me locked up till I was black in the face. Then came the regimental doctor, brandishing his fist under my nose and shouting in German, "You dirty hound, you lousy scab, you miserable turd, you socialist sod!" I looked them all squarely in the eyes without blinking and kept quiet, my right hand at the peak of my cap and my left on the seam of my trousers. They ran around me like dogs and yapped at me, but I did nothing. I kept mum, saluted, left hand on the seam of my trousers. When they'd been raging like this for about half an hour, the colonel rushed at me and roared, "Are you a half-wit or aren't you?" "Humbly report, sir, I'm a half-wit."
"Very well, then. 21 days strict confinement for imbecility, 2 days a week fasting, a month confined to barracks, 48 hours in handcuffs, immediate arrest, don't let him eat, truss him, show him that the monarchy doesn't need half-wits. We'll flog those newspapers out of your head, you bastard," the colonel decided after flying around for a long time.
But while I was sitting in jug, miracles were happening in the barracks. Our colonel forbade our soldiers to read anything at all, even the Prague official news. In the canteen, they weren't even allowed to use the newspapers for wrapping up frankfurters or bits of cheese. From that time, all the soldiers started to read, and our regiment became the best educated. We read all the newspapers, and in every company they made up rhymes and songs against the colonel. And when anything happened in the regiment, you'd always find some public benefactor who sent it to the newspapers under the title Maltreatment of the Troops. And they didn't stop at that. They wrote to the parliamentary deputies in Vienna, asking them to take up their case. And the deputies began to make interpolations one after the other, saying that our colonel was a monster and such like. A minister sent a commission to us to investigate the case, and a Franta Henkel from Chluboka got 2 years for being the chap who got onto the deputies in Vienna because of the knock across the jaw he got from the colonel on the drill ground. Later, when the commission went away, our colonel made us all fall in, the whole regiment, and told us that a soldier is a soldier, that he must shut his mug and do his job, and if he doesn't like anything, then it's a breach of discipline. So you, you bloody bastards, thought that that commission would help you, said the colonel. A shit they helped you. And now every company will march past me and repeat aloud what I've said. And so we marched to where the colonel stood, one company after the other, eyes right, and our hands on our rifle slings, and shouted at him, and so we bloody bastards thought that that commission would help us. A shit they helped us. The colonel doubled up with laughter until the 11th company marched up. They marched, they stamped, but when they reached the colonel, nothing at all, not the faintest sound. The colonel got red as a turkey cock, marched the 11th company back and made them repeat the operation once more. They marched past in silence, and each rank after the other stared the colonel insolently in the eyes. "Stand at ease," said the colonel, and paced up and down the yard, lashing his boots with his riding crop and spitting about the place. Then he suddenly stopped and roared out, "Dismiss," mounted his old crock, and away he was out of the gate. We waited to see what would happen to the 11th company, but still there was nothing. We waited one day, then another, and then a whole week. But still nothing happened. The colonel never appeared in the barracks at all, which gave great joy to the men, the NCOs and the officers. After that we got a new colonel, and it was rumoured that the old one was in a sanatorium because he'd written a letter in his own hand to His Imperial Majesty telling him that the 11th Company had mutinied.
The time for the doctor's afternoon round approached. Dr. Grönstein went from bed to bed, followed by the medical orderly officer, with his notebook.
Makuna? Present. Enema and aspirin. Bocconi? Present. Stomach pump and quinine. Govarik? Present. Enema and aspirin. Kotatko? Present. Stomach pump and quinine.
And so it went on, one after the other, mercilessly, mechanically, briskly.
Švejk? Present.
Dr. Grünstein looked at the new acquisition.
What's the matter with you? Humbly report, I've got rheumatism.
In the course of his practice, Dr. Grünstein had grown accustomed to be gently ironical, which was much more effective than shouting.
Aha! Rheumatism, he said to Švejk. Then you've got a jolly serious illness. It's really a coincidence getting rheumatism just at the time when there is a world war on and you got to go to the front. I think you must be awfully sorry.
Humbly report, sir, I am awfully sorry.
Well, there you are, you see, he's awfully sorry. It's really awfully nice of you that with your rheumatism you've not forgotten us just at this particular moment. In peacetime, a poor chap like him runs about like a young goat. But as soon as war breaks out, he immediately gets rheumatism and suddenly his knees don't work. Your knees hurt, I suppose. Humbly report, I do, sir. And you can't sleep a wink the whole night, can you? Rheumatism's a very dangerous, painful and grave illness. We've already had good experience with rheumatics here. Strict diet? And other treatments of ours have proved very effective. Here you'll be fit quicker than in Pristani, and you'll march to the front like greased lightning.
Turning to the hospital orderly, he said,
write this down. Švejk, strict diet, stomach pump twice a day, enema once a day, and we'll see how it goes after that. For the time being, take him to the consulting room, pump his stomach, and when he comes to, give him an enema, but a real good one, until he screams blue murder and his rheumatism gets frightened and runs away.
Then, turning to all the beds, the doctor made a speech full of noble and rational moral maxims.
Don't imagine that I'm just a bloody half-wit who swallows all your bull. Your tricks don't rattle me in the least. I know you're all malingerers and you want to desert from the war, and I'll treat you as such. I've survived hundreds and hundreds of soldiers like you. Masses of people have lain on these beds here who had nothing wrong with them at all, except that they hadn't got a soldier's guts. While their comrades were fighting on the battlefields, they thought they'd lounge about in bed, get hospital rations, and wait until the war flew by. But they all found they'd made a bloody mistake, and all of you'll find you've made a bloody mistake, too. In 20 years' time, you'll be still screaming in your sleep when you dream of how you tried it on with me.
Humbly report, sir,
came a gentle voice from the bed at the window.
I'm well again. I noticed in the night that my asthma's gone.
Your name?
Kovarik. Humbly report, I have to have an enema.
Good. You'll still get an enema for the road, Dr. Grunstein decided. So that you don't complain that we didn't give you treatment here. Now, all the patients whose names I've read out fall in and follow the orderly so that each can get what's due to him.
And each one got a handsome dose of what had been prescribed. And if any of them tried to work on those who were executing the orders by means of prayers or threats that they might too once join the medical corps and the executioners might fall into their hands, Švejk at least bore himself with steadfastness.
Don't spare me,
he invited the myrmidon who was giving him the enema.
Remember your oath. Even if it was your father or your own brother who was lying here, give him an enema without batting an eyelid. Try hard to think that Austria rests on these enemas and victory is ours.
The next day on his round, Dr. Grunstein asked Švejk how he was enjoying being in the military hospital. Švejk answered that it was a fair and high-minded institution. In reward, he received the same as the day before, plus aspirin and 3 quinine powders, which they dissolved into water, so that he should drink them at once. And not even Socrates drank his hemlock bowl with such composure as did Švejk his quinine, when Dr. Grunstein was trying out on him all his various degrees of torture. When they wrapped Švejk up in a wet sheet in the presence of the doctor, his answer to the question how he liked it now was, "Humbly report, sir, it's like being in a swimming pool or at the seaside."
"Have you still got rheumatism?" "Humbly report, sir, it doesn't seem to want to get better."
Švejk was subjected to new tortures. At that time, the widow of the infantry general, Baroness von Botzenheim, took great pains to find that soldier about whom Boemi had recently published a report that, cripple as he was, he had had himself pushed in a bath chair, shouting to Belgrade, which patriotic pronouncement induced the editorial staff of Boemi to invite their readers to organize collections in aid of the loyal and heroic cripple. Finally, after inquiries at police headquarters, it was ascertained that the man in question was Švejk, and after that it was easy to make a search for him. Baroness von Botzenheim went to the Hradkani, taking with her her lady companion and her footman with a hamper. The poor Baroness had no idea what it meant for someone to be lying in the hospital of the garrison jail. Her visiting card opened the prison door for her. In the office they were awfully nice to her, and in 5 minutes she learnt that the good soldier Švejk, whom she was looking for, lay in the 3rd hut, bed number 17. She was accompanied by Dr. Grunstein himself, who was quite flabbergasted by it. Švejk was just sitting up in bed after the usual daily procedure prescribed by Dr. Grunstein, surrounded by a group of emaciated and starved malingerers who had not yet given up and was stubbornly struggling with Dr. Grunstein on the battlefield of strict diet. Anyone who had listened to them would have had the impression that he was in the company of epicures, in a school of cordon bleu cuisine or a course for gourmets.
"You can even eat ordinary suet cracklings if they are warm,"
a patient with inveterate stomach catarrh was just telling the others at this moment.
"As the suet boils, you squeeze the cracklings dry, add salt and pepper, and I can tell you that goose cracklings are not in the same class."
"You leave goose cracklings alone," said a man with cancer of the stomach. "There's nothing to touch them. What are pork cracklings in comparison? Of course, you must fry them until they're golden brown, like the Jews do. They take a fat goose, draw the fat off with the skin, and fry it."
"You know, you're quite wrong as far as pork cracklings are concerned," Schweik's neighbour put in. "Of course, I'm talking about cracklings of homemade fat, what they call homemade cracklings. They're not brown, and they're not yellow. They must be something between the two shades. These kinds of cracklings mustn't be either too soft or too hard, and they mustn't be crunchy or they're overcooked. They must melt on the tongue, and you mustn't feel the fat dripping on your chin."
"Which of you have eaten horse cracklings?" chimed in a new voice.
But there was no answer, because at that moment the medical orderly ran in.
"Everybody in bed! An archduchess is coming here! Don't anyone dare show his dirty legs outside the bed!"
And not even an archduchess could have entered the ward with such dignity, as did Baroness von Botzenheim. After her, the whole suite poured in, including even the quartermaster sergeant major of the hospital, who saw in all this the mysterious hand of accounts control, which was going to tear him away from his fat feeding trough at the base and deliver him to the tender mercies of the shrapnel somewhere under the barbed wire posts. He was pale, but Dr. Grunstein was even paler. Before his eyes, there danced the old baroness's small visiting card with her title Widow of a General, and everything which could be associated with it, like connections, protection, complaints, transfer to the front, and other frightful things.
"Here you have Švejk," he said,
endeavouring to preserve an artificial composure, and leading the Baroness von Botzenheim to Švejk's bed.
"He behaves with great patience."
Baroness von Botzenheim sat down on the chair prepared for her at Švejk's bed and said,
"Czech soldier, good soldier, cripple, soldier is brave, soldier I love very much, Czech Austrian."
At that, she stroked Švejk on his unshaven cheeks and went on,
"I read everything in the newspapers. I bring you yum-yum, something to bite, to smoke, to zack. Czech soldier, good soldier. Johann, come here."
Her footman, whose bristly side whiskers recalled the notorious killer Babinski, dragged a voluminous hamper to the bed, while the old baroness's companion, a tall lady with a tearful face, sat down on Švejk's bed and smoothed out his straw pillow under his back, with the fixed idea that this was what ought to be done for sick heroes. In the meantime, the baroness drew presents out of the hamper. A dozen roast chickens wrapped up in pink silk paper and tied with a yellow and black silk ribbon. Two bottles of a war liqueur with the label "God strafe England," God punish England. On the back of the label was a picture of Franz Josef and Wilhelm clasping hands as though they were going to play the nursery game, "Bunny sat alone in his hole, poor little bunny, what's wrong with you that you can't hop?" Then she took out of the hamper three bottles of wine for the convalescent and two boxes of cigarettes. She set out everything elegantly on the empty bed next to Švejk's, where she also put a beautifully bound book, Stories from the Life of Our Monarch, which had been written by the present meritorious chief editor of our official Czechoslovak Republic, who doted on old France. Packets of chocolate with the same inscription, "Gott strafe England," and again with pictures of the Austrian and German emperors, found their way to the bed. On the chocolate, they were no longer clasping hands. Each was acting on his own and turning his back to the other. There was a beautiful toothbrush with two rows of bristles and the inscription Vidibus Unitus, with united forces, so that anyone who cleaned his teeth should remember Austria. An elegant and extremely useful little gift for the front and the trenches was a manicure set. On the case was a picture showing shrapnel bursting and a man in a steel helmet rushing forward with fixed bayonet, and underneath it was written in German, "For God, Emperor, and Fatherland." There was a tin of biscuits, without a picture on it, but with a verse in German instead, together with a Czech translation on the back. "Austria, thou noble house, thy banners wide unfurl. Thy flags shall flutter proud on high. Austria shall never die." The last gift was a white hyacinth in a flower pot. When all of this lay unpacked on the bed, the Baroness von Botzenheim could not restrain her tears for emotion. Several famished malingerers felt their mouths water. The Baroness's companion propped up the seated Švejk and wept too. There was a silence of the grave, which was suddenly broken by Švejk, who said with his hands clasped in prayer, "Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come." Pardon me, your ladyship, it's not right. I mean to say, "O God, our Father in heaven, bless for us these gifts that we may enjoy them thanks to thy goodness. Amen." After these words, he took a chicken from the bed and started to devour it under the horrified gaze of Dr. Grunstein.
"Ah, how he enjoys it, poor soldier," the old Baroness whispered enthusiastically to Dr. Grunstein. "He's certainly well again and can go to the battlefield. I'm really very glad that my gifts stand him in such good stead."
Then she walked from bed to bed, distributing cigarettes and chocolate creams. When she came back again to Švejk after her promenade, she stroked his hair, said in German, "God protect you all," and went out of the door with her whole escort. Before Dr. Grönstein could return from below, where he had gone to see the Baroness out, Švejk had distributed the chickens. They were bolted by the patient so quickly that Dr. Grönstein found only a heap of bones gnawed cleanly, as though the chickens had fallen alive into a nest of vultures and the sun had been beating down on their gnawed bones for several months. The war liquor and the three bottles of wine had also disappeared. The packets of chocolate and the box of biscuits were likewise lost in the patient's stomachs. Someone had even drunk up the bottle of nail polish which was in the manicure set and eaten the toothpaste which had been enclosed with the toothbrush. When Dr. Grunstein returned, he resumed his belligerent pose and delivered a long speech. A stone fell from his heart now that the visitors had gone. The pile of gnawed bones confirmed his belief that they were all incorrigible.
"Men," he burst out, "if you'd had a little sense, you'd have left it all untouched and said to yourselves, 'If we eat it all up, then the doctor won't believe that we are very ill.' Now you've yourselves provided me with proof that you don't appreciate my kindness. I pump your stomachs, I give you enemas, I try to keep you on strict diet, and you go and stuff up your stomachs again. You want to get stomach catarrh? You're making a great mistake. Before your stomach tries to digest all this, I'll clean it out for you so thoroughly that you'll remember it to your dying day and tell your children how you once gobbled up chickens and gorged yourself on various other delicacies, and how they didn't stay in your stomach 15 minutes because they pumped it out while it was still warm. And now, fall in, all of you, run after the other, so you don't forget that I'm not a bloody fool like you are, but a little bit cleverer than the whole lot of you together. In addition,
I want to inform you that tomorrow I'm going to send a commission to you because you've been lazing around here far too long and there's nothing wrong with any of you. If in those 5 minutes you could pig it and stuff your stomachs up so chock full as you did just now.
1, 2, 3, march!
When it was Schweig's turn, Dr. Grunstein looked at him and a memory of the mysterious visit of the day prompted him to ask,
You know, Her Excellency?
She's my stepmother, Schweik answered calmly. In 10 years she abandoned me, and now she's found me again.
And Dr. Grunstein said tersely,
Afterwards give Schweik an extra enema.
In the evening, melancholy reigned among the bunks. A few hours earlier, all of them had had in their stomachs various good and tasty things, and now they only had weak tea and a slice of bread. From the window could be heard the voice of number 21.
Do you know, chaps, that I prefer fried chicken to roast?
Somebody growled,
Give him the blanket treatment.
But they were all so weak after the unsuccessful banquets that no one stirred. Dr. Grunstein was as good as his word. In the morning there came several military doctors from the famous commission. They went solemnly past the rows of beds and said nothing else but, Put out your tongue. Schweik put his tongue out so far that his face made an idiotic grimace and his eyes screwed up.
Humbly report, sir, I don't have a longer tongue than that.
And an interesting discussion arose between Schweik and the commission. Schweik asserted that he had made this observation in case they might think he was trying to hide his tongue from them. The members of the commission, however, were remarkably divided in their conclusions about Schweik. Half of them insisted that Schweik was a halfwit, while the other half insisted he was a scoundrel who was trying to make fun of the war.
It'll be a bloody miracle, roared the chairman of the commission at Schweik, if we don't get the better of you.
Schweik looked at the whole commission with the godlike composure of an innocent child. The senior staff doctor came up close to Schweik.
I'd like to know, you swine, what you're thinking about now.
Humbly report, sir, I don't think at all.
Himmel Donnerwetter,
bawled one of the members of the commission, rattling his sabre.
So he doesn't think at all? Why in God's name don't you think, you Siamese elephant?
Humbly report, I don't think because that's forbidden to soldiers on duty.
When I was in the 91st Regiment some years ago, our captain always used to say, A soldier mustn't think for himself. His superiors do it for him. As soon as a soldier begins to think, he's no longer a soldier, but a dirty, lousy civilian. Thinking doesn't get you anywhere.
Shut your mug,
the chairman of the commission interrupted Schweik in fury.
We know all about you already. The swine thinks he'll be taken for a genuine idiot. You're not an idiot at all, Schweik. You're cunning. You're foxy. You're a scoundrel. You're a hooligan. You're a lousy bastard. Do you understand?
Humbly report, sir. I understand.
I've already told you to shut your mug. Did you hear?
Humbly report, sir. I heard that I must shut my mug.
Himmel Herrgott, then shut it. When I've given you orders, you know very well that you must stop talking rot.
Humbly report, sir. I know well I must stop talking rot.
The military gentleman exchanged glances and called the sergeant major.
Take this man to the office, said the senior staff doctor, pointing to Schweik, and wait for our announcement and report. At the garrison they'll knock all this drivel out of his head.
The fellow's as fit as a fiddle. He's only shamming, and into the bargain he talks rot and tries to make fun of his superiors. He thinks they're only here for his amusement, and that the whole war's a joke, a laughing matter.
At the garrison, Schweik, they'll soon show you that war's no picnic.
Schweik went off with the sergeant major to the office, and on the way through the courtyard hummed to himself, I always thought that war was fun, a week or two and home I'd run. And while in the office the duty officer was bellowing at Schweik that bastards like him ought to be shot, in the wards upstairs the commission was making short shrift with the malingerers. Of 70 patients, only 2 got through. One had had a leg torn off by a shell, and the other
suffered from genuine bone decay. These two were the only ones who did not hear the word tauglich. All the others, including even the three dying of consumption, were certified fit for service at the front, whereupon the senior staff doctor did not deny himself the opportunity of making a speech. His speech was interlarded with the most variegated oaths and was brief in content. They were all swine and dung, and only if they were to fight valiantly for his imperial majesty would they be fit to return to human society, and after the war be forgiven for having tried to get out of military service and been malingerers. He himself, however, didn't believe that this would happen and thought the gallows were in store for them all. A youngish army doctor, whose soul was still pure and uncorrupted, asked the senior staff doctor if he might say a few words too. His speech distinguished himself from that of his superior by its optimism and naivety. He spoke in German. He dwelt long on the fact that each of them who was leaving the hospital to join their regiments at the front must be conqueror and knight. He was convinced they would be skillful in handling their weapons on the battlefield and honourable in all their dealings in war and in private life. They would be unconquerable warriors, mindful of the glory of Radetzky and Prince Eugene of Savoy. With their blood, they would fertilize the vast fields of glory of the monarchy and victoriously accomplish the task to which history had predestined them. With fearless courage, despising their lives, they would charge forward under the bullet-ridden ensigns of their regiments towards new glories and new victories. Later, in the corridor, the senior staff doctor said to this naive man, "My dear colleague, I can assure you it's all a complete waste of time. Why, not even Radetzky or your Prince Eugene of Savoy could make soldiers out of bastards like them. Whether you speak to them like an angel or a devil, it all comes to the same thing. They're a gang of crooks." 9. Švejk in the garrison jail. For people who did not want to go to the front, the last refuge was the garrison jail. I once knew a probationary teacher who was a mathematician and did not want to serve in the artillery and shoot people. So he stole a lieutenant's watch to get himself into the garrison jail. He did this deliberately. War neither impressed nor enchanted him. Shooting at the enemy and killing with shrapnel and shells equally unhappy probationary teachers of mathematics serving on the other side seemed to him sheer idiocy. "I don't want to be hated for my brutality," he said to himself, and calmly stole the watch. First they examined his mental condition, but when he said he wanted to get rich quick, they sent him off to the garrison jail. There were a lot more people like that sitting there for theft or fraud, idealists and non-idealists. There were people who saw the war as a way of increasing their income, those various quartermaster sergeants at the base or at the front, who were up to all possible kinds of fiddles with messing and pay, and also petty thieves who were 1,000 times more honest than the blackguards who sent them there. And soldiers sat there who had committed various other offences of a purely military kind, such as insubordination, attempted mutiny or desertion. Then came the political prisoners, who were in a special class. 80% of them were utterly innocent, and of these, 99% were sentenced. The whole establishment of the office of the judge advocate was magnificent. Every state on the brink of total political, economic, and moral collapse has an establishment like this. The aura of past power and glory clings to its courts, police, gendarmerie, and venal pack of informers. In every military unit, Austria had her snoopers who spied on their comrades, sleeping on the same bunks with them and sharing their bread on the march. In addition, the garrison jail was supplied with material by the state security, Messrs. Klima, Slavicek and Co. The military censorship consigned here the writers of letters exchanged between the men at the front
and the despairing ones they had left behind at home. The gendarmes even brought here poor old peasant pensioners who had written letters to the front, and the court-martial jugged them for 12 years as a punishment for their words of consolation and their descriptions of the misery at home. From the Khadkani garrison, the road led through Brevnov to the drill ground at Motol. Along it, a procession would pass, headed by a man under military escort with his hands manacled and followed by a cart with a coffin on it. On the drill ground was heard the curt order, "Fire!" And then, in all the regiments and battalions, they read out the regimental order that one more man had been shot for mutiny during call-up when his wife, not bearing to be parted from him, had been slashed by the captain's sabre. And in the garrison jail, the triumvirate, Staff Warder Slavik, Captain Linhart, and Sergeant Major Repa, alias the hangman, were getting on with the job. How many did they flog in solitary confinement? Perhaps in the Republic today, Captain Linhart is still a captain. I hope for his sake his years of service in the garrison jail will count towards his pension. They do in the case of Slavicek and Klima from the state security. Repa has returned to civilian life and carries on his profession as a master builder. Perhaps he is a member of one of the patriotic societies in the Republic. Under the Republic, Staff Warder Slavik became a thief and is today in jail. The poor man could not set himself up so comfortably in the Republic as the other military gentlemen did. It was quite natural that when he took charge of Švejk, Staff Warder Slavik gave him a look of mute reproach, as much as to say, "So, you've got a tarnished reputation too, if you've got yourself here. Well, love, we'll sweeten your stay here as we do for anyone who's fallen into our hands, and you know that our hands aren't exactly the ladies' kind." And to add weight to his look, he thrust his muscular, fat fist under Švejk's nose and said, "Sniff that, you bastard." Švejk sniffed it and observed, "I wouldn't like to get that in the nose. It smells of the graveyard." This calm, considered remark appealed to the staff warder.
"Hey," he said, prodding Švejk in the stomach with his fist.
"Stand straight! What's that you've got in your pockets? If it's cigarettes, you can leave them here. And hand over your money, too, so that they don't steal it off you. Haven't you got anything else? Honest to God, it don't tell lies now. You'll be punished for lying."
"Where shall we put him?"
asked Sergeant Major Repa.
"In number 16, the staff warder decided, "among the pants. Don't you see that Captain Linhart has marked his papers, 'Guard and watch closely'?" "Oh, yes, indeed," he declared solemnly to Švejk. "Vermin are treated like vermin. If anyone gets awkward, we drag him off to the solitary. There we break all his ribs and leave him until he's a goner. That's our right. Like we did with that butcher, eh, Raper?"
"Yes, he gave us a lot of trouble, sir,"
replied Sergeant Major Raper, dreamily.
"What a body. I stamped on him for more than 5 minutes until his ribs began to crack and blood poured out of his mouth. And he lived for another 10 days. A really tough customer."
"So you see, you bastard, what happens here when anyone starts getting awkward or trying to escape,"
said Staff Warder Slavik, concluding his pedagogical discourse.
"It's sheer suicide. And, by the way, suicide's punished too. And God help you, you miserable shit, if when there's an inspection you take it into your head to complain about anything. When there's an inspection and you're asked, 'Have you any complaints?' you have to stand at attention, you stinking vermin, salute and answer, 'Humbly report none, I'm completely satisfied.' Now what are you going to say, you lousy oaf? Repeat what I said. 'Humbly report none, I'm completely satisfied,'" Švejk repeated, with such a sweet expression on his face that the staff warder was misled and took it for honest zeal and decency.
"Now strip down your pants and go to number 16, he said, affably,
without adding either shit, stinking vermin, or lousy oaf, as he usually did. In number 16, Švejk encountered 20 men in their pants. They were all men whose papers had been marked guard and watch closely, and who were now being watched very carefully so that they should not escape. If those pants had been clean and there had been no bars on the windows, you might at first glance have supposed that you were in the dressing room of some bathing establishment. Sergeant Major Repa handed Švejk over to the cell commander, a hairy fellow in an unbuttoned shirt. He wrote Švejk's name down on a piece of paper which was hanging on the wall and said to him,
"Tomorrow we're going to have a show. They'll take us to the chapel to hear a sermon. We shall all of us be standing in our pants right under the pulpit. There'll be some fun."
As in all prisons and penitentiaries, the local chapel was very popular in the garrison jail, too. Not that enforced attendance at it brought the congregation nearer to God, or that the prisoners learnt more about morality. There could be no question of any nonsense of that kind. The service and sermons were a marvellous thrill in the boredom of the garrison jail. It was not a question of getting nearer to God, but of the hope of finding on the way, in the corridor or in the courtyard, a fag end or a cigar end. A little fag end, lying about hopelessly in a spittoon or somewhere in the dust on the floor, stole the show and God was nowhere. That little stinking object triumphed over God and the salvation of the soul. Then on top of that came the sermon, which was a rare picnic, for the chaplain, Otto Katz, was really a lovely man. His sermons were unusually exciting and amusing, and they refreshed the boredom of the garrison jail. He could drivel so beautifully about the infinite grace of God and give uplift to the abandoned prisoners and disgraced men. He could let off such resounding oaths from the pulpit and the altar. He could roar out his ite missa est so gorgeously at the altar, conduct the whole service in such an original way, and turn the whole order of the Holy Mass upside down. When he was thoroughly drunk, he could invent entirely new prayers and a new Holy Mass, even a liturgy of his own, something which was quite unheard of here. And then, what a scream when he sometimes slipped and fell over with the chalice, the Holy Sacrament, or the missal, loudly accusing the server from the prison unit of having purposely tripped him up and dealing him out solitary confinement or irons before the Holy Communion itself. And the recipient was happy, because it was an inseparable part of the whole pantomime in the prison chapel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.